All right, folks, let me get this adjusted just a little bit. Hey, we've got a great crowd here tonight. Thanks so much for coming in to Brave New Books. We're doing a live broadcast here in Austin, Texas. This is for our good friend Jim Mars. I think we all can consider Jim a friend at this point. You know, he's down here. He's on TV like every other day now. I turned the History Channel on. And, yeah, give him a round of applause. You know, we're blessed here in Texas to have people like Jim here, native Texans, and we're cursed at the same time because, you know, there's a yin and yang going on. For all the good we have, there's a lot of evil emanating from here. And before we get going on this alien agenda, we're going to talk about something real quick. Monday at the state capitol, if you guys can be there, I need you to get there. We've got a Senate bill coming up, and it's on the animal chipping, on the NAIS, and the premise ID. Yeah. Now, I'm not going to bore you with a bunch of elite quotes and Kissinger quotes, but you know, they know that if they can control the food and the water, they can control you. Obama's got his little million-man army in place, this little green revolution army that's going to monitor food now. And there's also bills to keep you from growing food. So be very aware, you know, we can't do much fighting against what's coming unless we can have a little bit of food in our belly. So the website to go to, sorry about this boring part, but it's really important, farmandranchfreedom.org. That's Judith McGeary's website. It's farmandranchfreedom.org. And Monday, the 23rd of March at 3 p.m., and it's in the extension. It's kind of the catacombs of the Capitol where they do the, you know, administrative business, not the legal business of government. But, yeah, it's room E1.012. E1.012. Guys, get there, sign up, and if you can't do that, go to the website. There's some forms to send emails and letters to your senators. We've got to protect our food integrity at this point. Not everybody's going to want to eat fresh food. They're going to have food of convenience, and that's okay for most, but we need to arm ourselves.
What time is it?
3 o'clock Monday.
Very, very important.
Be there.
Please be there.
Very important.
All right. My name is Kevin Smith, and I've been involved in the truth movement and the patriot movement or whatever, alternate media movement, whatever you want to call it. And I did a lot to make 9/11 more acceptable to mainstream. And I looked for a lot of avenues to get that message out there where we wouldn't just be preaching to the choir all the time and make it and figure out ways that, you know, someone's ox was being gored. Maybe not the way mine was, but a way to reach out to them and make them understand that, hey, there's some things about 9/11. It's an inside job. You need to research it. And one thing I used to run away from with, like, my hair on fire was anybody that was talking about UFOs. Anybody that, and not because I come, my father's an aerospace engineer. I was taught to fly by a two-star general. These are things that we all knew, but if you didn't want to risk your career, you kept quiet about it. And I just looked at it from a point of view that whenever I've been challenged about 9/11, it's the Bigfoot, the grassy knoll, chupacabra, you know the routine. How it's the template they use to tear you down. So I always tried to separate it. But there's a problem, though, because once you start to understand in any of these topics that you've been lied to, and the history that you've been fed was incorrect, or at best a spin of the real truth, then you start to see a lot of commonalities. And when you understand about the JFK assassination, it makes it that much easier to understand about the Nazis running this country now. And so these things start to become intertwined. But we run into a problem, especially in 9/11 truth, is that once we came up with a sexy new theory on something, we tend to cast everything that we knew that was proven away. And I think it kind of goes to that Goering saying, you know, the bigger the lie, the more apt people are to believe it. So we run into a problem with people wanting to have the newest, sexiest thing that they can get excited about, maybe put their name on and claim, you know, their claim of fame. So what we have here with Mr. Jim Mars is a professional, trained journalist, an investigative reporter, and the oxymoron of being Army intelligence also. But we have a real Texan that looked into the stuff in depth, speculated very little and built facts around his case and was able to present it in a way that's understandable and acceptable. And that's one of the... Jim, you're the only guy. You're the only guy that I will let mix 9/11 and stand in the same shot with in UFOs because he can defend it. He can break it down and he can say, well, today we're talking about aliens or UFOs. Tomorrow we're going to talk about the Nazis and 9/11. So I wouldn't get up here and introduce a guy like this if I didn't have full faith in him. So I'm going to shut up. Everybody, Jim Mars, we're going to talk about UFOs.
Thank you so much, Kevin. Yeah, that kind of stole some of my thunder, though. But he's absolutely right. When Crossfire came out and right after the Oliver Stone movie, you know, I was the darling of the JFK research community. And then I wrote Alien Agenda. I was disinvited to their conferences, you know. I was held at arm's length for about 6-8 years because, I wrote about UFOs, as if that somehow disqualifies me from knowing anything about anything else. But that time has passed. Just this past November, I was invited back to the JFK Lancer thing in Dallas, and they actually gave me an award for being one of the early, long-time, and most steadfast seekers of truth in the JFK assassination, so maybe I've been slightly rehabilitated. All right, now I see a lot of familiar faces, so a lot of you have been down here before to New Break Books, and you've heard me talk about 9/11, and you've heard me talk about the National Socialist takeover in this country, which now they got so blatant in their excesses that in November, thanks to the corporate mass media, we have now shifted from national socialism to Marxist socialism. And if you think that this is some kind of fringe conspiracy theory, just consider the cover of Newsweek a couple of weeks ago. Now we are all socialist. Yeah, we are. But when did we ever get the chance to vote for socialism? Is that really what we want, you know? And is that, who's behind all that? And before, let me add to one more thing, because I know some of you people are already cringing because you're probably great Obama fans. And let me say right off the bat, I got nothing personally against Barack Hussein Obama any more than I had against George W. Bush personally. I know people who are good friends with George W. Bush, and they assured me that he was quite a good old boy. And I'm not prepared to argue. He may very well have been. But I think what we all understand is that he wasn't in charge. Dick Cheney was in charge. And his little presidential assassination ring, if you've happen to read that and know about what Seymour Hirst has now let out of the bag. And Dad, he was also there. And
James Baker.
And speaking of Dad, just to add a coda to those of you who heard my Rise of the Fourth Reich talk, last July in Germany, George Herbert Walker Bush was presented with this great award and hailed as being the one person most responsible for the reunification of Germany. George Herbert Walker Bush? And who gave him this award? Henry Kissinger. It gets better. And where did this award ceremony take place? On the shores of the Wannsee. Does anybody remember the Wannsee Conference of 1942? This is where the Nazis all met and decided on the final solution. Now, do you think this was just some kind of sheer coincidence? Or are they thumbing their nose at us? And speaking of Dr. Kissinger, for any of you who are still hoping that Barack Obama may bring us some change, let me quote from the remarks of his new national security advisor, General James L. Jones, who last month at the Munich Security Conference got up and thanked them for honoring Dr. Kissinger, who, by the way, cannot travel to certain countries because there are warrants out for his arrest for war crimes, okay? And James L. Jones, Obama's national security advisor, says, "Thank you, congratulations for honoring Dr. Kissinger," says, "as the latest national security advisor for the United States, I take my daily orders from Dr. Kissinger," coming through Brent Snowcroft and Sandy Berger. We have a chain of command in the National Security Council, and it still exists today. Excuse me, where's the change? I didn't vote for Henry Kissinger. And these are the same tools that have been in there, were there in the Clinton administration when they stripped our military. And Henry Kissinger's been there since Nixon. He is the architect of the very foreign policy that's gotten us in the mess we're in now. So what's changed, folks? I submit to you, nothing. But now, away from mundane politics, we're going to talk about UFOs. Let me quickly see a show of hands. How many of you have had or know about someone who has had a UFO experience? Whoa! 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. I took a head count ahead of time. We've got about 60 people here, maybe plus or minus. And that looked to be about half of you. Half the people in this audience have had or know of some UFO experience. Now extrapolate that up to the 300 million population of the United States. Half the people in this country know about UFOs. Okay? And I guarantee you that the higher you get, and you get away from the guy in the street, and you get away from the people who just get their information from CNN or Fox, and you start talking to people high in the military, high in intelligence, or in the upper echelons of the political circles, they don't snicker at you about UFOs, because they know it's here. And my main message tonight is, if you dismiss the whole topic of UFOs, then folks, you will never, ever be able to truthfully understand what's going on in the world, because you've just tossed out a big piece of the puzzle. So with that, let me bring you up to speed on UFOs. Some of this is old stuff to some of you. Some of it, hopefully, will be new. Oops. I guess it helps turn it on. Okay. First off, you go back, and if you go Google UFOs, or go back and look at the newspaper clips, you'll find that since 1947, there's been a literal barrage of information. And yeah, some of them are hoaxes, some of them are deluded people, some of them are strange, you know, but hey, you can discount half of them or more, and you still have a significant number of reports. It means there's something going on, okay? Now, early on, the explanation was that there's nothing up there, folks. It's all just hallucinations or some sort of group psychosis. Well, you know, even as a young reporter, I thought, oh, wait a minute. A heretofore undiagnosed contagious mass psychosis. Whoa, what a story. But you don't see that anymore, do you? And you've never seen anything about that because it's not true. And you don't ever hear these explanations anymore, but why? Because now with YouTube and the computer, there's not a day goes by that somebody's not posting photographs and film and camera snapshots of a UFO. So obviously you can't take a picture of an hallucination or of a psychosis. So that explanation, you don't hear that anymore. So today it's, oh, well, it's just misidentified aircraft or satellites, or the planet Venus, or probably it's secret government test craft, okay? So I always thought, well, wouldn't it be great if there was a really documented story of a UFO that occurred before any of that was in the air? And you know what? There is. And of course, it all got started with Kenneth Arnold, 1947, and that got the whole flying saucer thing going, but they all said, well, it's just misidentified aircraft. Well, it was recorded in Aurora, Texas. Here's a story that appeared in the Dallas Morning News, April the 19th, 1897. 6 years before the Wright brothers flew. 6 years before the first powered balloon flight in the United States, the California era. About 6 o'clock this morning, the early riser of Aurora was astonished at the sudden appearance of the airship, which had been sailing through the country, traveling due north and much nearer the earth than ever before. Evidently, some of the machinery is out of order because it's making a speed of only 10 or 12 miles an hour. Think about that, 10 or 12 miles an hour. Anybody know about aviation? Anybody know about lift? It's not airspeed, is it, Kevin? Can't stay in the air at 10 or 12 miles an hour, so there had to be something else going on. It sailed directly over the public square, and when it reached the north part of town, collided with the tower of Judge Proctor's windmill, went to pieces with a terrific explosion, scattering debris over several acres of ground, wrecking the windmill and water tank, and destroying the judge's flower garden. Shame, shame. The pilot of the ship is supposed to have been the only one on board, and while his remains are badly disfigured, enough of the original have been picked up to show that he was not an inhabitant of this world. Whoa! And there's a picture of the little tombstone, because he was buried in the Aurora Cemetery. And there is a photograph of the little headstone, so you'll know that I'm not just making this up. And when I got onto this story in 1973, that headstone was still there. And it was very interesting because, as you can see here, we put a chalk outline on the little design that was etched in it. And you see this inverted V with little circles along the center of it. Now, so far, I'm trying to deal with conspiracy facts. People accuse me of being a conspiracy theorist, okay? I sometimes bristle at that because I try to explain, if you can prove something, it's not a theory, all right? But now, here's a theory. I was under the impression, because you can see that this side of it kind of rounded, and then it's broken off here in the middle. So I was kind of under the impression when I was looking at it that it looks like half of it may have been broken off at some point, and you're only seeing half of what the original headstone was. So if you extrapolate the thing over to here and you duplicate and reverse this, what have you got? You've got a saucer-looking object with little portholes running along the side, okay? But did it happen? In 1973, there were three people still alive who were alive in the Aurora area in 1897. One of them said it was a hoax. One of them, Mary Evans, said, no, I remember my folks talking about it. I remember hearing the explosion, but they wouldn't let me go into town because I was only about 12 or 13 years old, but they came back and told me about it. So she says it actually happened. Then we got Charlie Stevens, who I talked to, and he actually saw the thing. And he said he saw it going over, and he said he heard an explosion, he saw the smoke coming up from town, and a young boy, he wanted to run up and see what had happened. Now, if Charlie was making up this story, what do you think he would say? He said, I ran a town, I saw these pieces, and I saw this little green guy, and he'd give you this big story. No, that's not what he told me. What he told me struck me as very truthful. He said his dad told him, no, son, we can't go to town. We have to finish the chores. Now, think about it, folks. 1897, rural Texas. If you didn't do the chores, you didn't eat. So I think that was a very truthful statement. So now you got Mary Evans, who was there, said it happened. You got Charlie Stevens, who was there, and he said it happened. And then you got this fella, Robert Brown, who found this odd thing in the 80s. That he claimed was a piece of the spaceship, except you can see how crudely made it is. I don't think this was a piece of the spaceship, but what's interesting is it's two pieces of metal banded together with this wire, and inside you can kind of see this copper-looking stuff. I think that maybe in the middle was a piece of the original spaceship, but we don't know, and he wouldn't give it up to go have it tested, so again, it's just a we don't know. Here's the original Dallas Morning News story. And so the two people there out of the three said it actually happened. Now the argument is, well, it was just a hoax story planted in the newspaper. Well, okay, that's possible. And I kind of bought into that for a long time until I got the complete front page of the Dallas Morning News for 1897. And folks, there are 16 stories on that front page. Every single one of them is talking about the silver cigar-shaped object flying through the skies of North Texas in 1897, and two or three of them even carrying accounts of carrying on a conversation with the crews. One of them, they were told, we come from a secret laboratory in New York, and we were testing this thing out, and it proved so successful, we just started sailing through the countryside. The next thing you knew, we were in Kansas. So we thought we'd come on down to Texas. Another story, they were told, we come from a hidden community at the North Pole, and we have these flying machines. And then in another account at that same period, a track inspector from Fort Worth encountered this silver cigar-shaped object, said there was a crew of uniformed people around it, and he was told, don't say anything about seeing us. We're on a secret mission. We're on our way to bomb Havana. Now, this is especially intriguing to me because this was in the spring of 1897. We didn't get into a war with Spain and Cuba until the spring of 1898, a year later. How did these people know that we were going to be in a war involving Cuba? Teddy Roosevelt and Rough Riders, remember your school? Okay, how did they know? Were they able to look in the time? Did they come from another time? I don't know, but something's very strange there. Okay? Right. Yeah, and all of this occurred before the Wright brothers split. In 1955, Dorothy Kilgallen told us the reality of it in this story that is absolutely legitimate because I copied it out of the files of the Fort Worth Star-Telegram. And she said that they come from other planets, and source of my information is a British official of cabinet rank. So they knew way back there that it was all real. Now, what the heck is going on? I missed all my... Anyway, same kind of out secrets. Before I get to the moon, let me wrap up on Aurora. So the only arguments they've had against Aurora is that, number one, one of the people from that time period, Robbie Hansen, said, oh, it was just a hoax. Now, unfortunately, her close friend was Etta Pegues, that was the Star-Telegram correspondent in that area. And so through the years, when everybody would contact Star-Telegram and say, hey, what about the Aurora spaceship, they would send them to Etta Pegues, and Etta Pegues would tell them it was all just a hoax. And you'll find lots of columns written in the Dallas News and stuff recently in the 70s and the 80s, in the 90s, and they said, oh, it was all just a hoax. And that's all basically because the stringer up there, the correspondent, Etta Pegues, told everybody it was a hoax. And she said this because Etta Pegues, her friend, told her it was a hoax. Well, I went and talked to Robbie Hansen, and her story was that she lived way outside of Aurora and never knew anything happened. Until one day, somebody rode by on horseback and told her father about this crash and the little man they buried in the cemetery, and her father laughed and laughed and said, well, that old Judge Proctor, what a joker. So that's her basis for believing it was a hoax. Although by her own story, she had no direct knowledge of it. So you got two people with direct knowledge, two people with indirect knowledge. One said it was a hoax, one said my parents were there, and you had Charlie Stevens who said it actually happened. Okay, and then of course their argument is that Judge Proctor didn't have a windmill, and that it was all a hoax story, and therefore there's no grave in the cemetery. Well, all this got laid to rest last summer. Have any of y'all seen the History Channel special? Bunch of you? Yeah. Good. Basically, this was aired back, I think, about Christmas time, and then they ran it again just about a week or so ago. They came with a scientific crew to Aurora, and they used ground-penetrating radar, and they found that there is a small grave at the site. Oops, took care of that argument. Then they went and managed to get the owner of the property to let them move the little well house, whereupon they found the footing for the windmill tower, or for the windlass. So that takes care of that argument. In fact, what I understood years ago was that it's true Judge Proctor did not have a windmill. He had a windlass, which is a wooden derrick that normally you could put a windmill on top of the blades, but he didn't have the windmill, but it was a derrick he used for the sump to operate the pump on his well. Okay, so now they've proved he did have this tower. It just got misidentified as a windmill instead of a windlass. Okay, but here's the clincher. Back in the 70s, we picked up odd pieces of metal there at the crash site, and a lot of it was very readily identifiable, old pieces of nail, chain, whatever. But then we also found some odd pieces that looked to be like molten aluminum. And we sent it off for study at North Texas. And I usually have, I don't know why these slides are all out of whack, we may get to this. And they, the physics department said some of these pieces were a little unusual, and one was particularly unusual because it was 90% iron, but it had no magnetic properties. But that was about all we had the time and money to do, so we left it at that. Well, what they did last summer is they also found globs, little tiny globs of what appeared to be molten aluminum, buried 6 inches into the ground and into the trees surrounding and into rocks, indicating a tremendous explosion. Okay, and then when they tested the metal, it did prove to be aluminum, but the metallic composition was not the same composition as modern aluminum or any of the aluminum that we know about. If you go back, even in the story in the Dallas News, it said the metal appeared to be some sort of metal, kind of like aluminum or silver. Well, so they knew about aluminum in 1897. But it had only been 2 years earlier, in 1895, that they'd been able to synthetically make aluminum. Prior to that, a little bit of aluminum cost about the same amount as gold or silver. So although they knew about aluminum, it was not in widespread use in 1897, certainly not in rural Texas. So, as far as I'm concerned, it happened. We had a spaceship crash. And by the way, it's on the Texas State Historical Marker at the Aurora Cemetery. So now let's look at another UFO, unidentified flying object. This one, you've all seen it. It's called the moon. But the moon's a very strange place. We've got the Maria, which they call the seas, which appear to be molten rocks that was thrown up onto the surface and then cooled into the what they call the Maria. And that's why when they went to the moon, they were expecting to find volcanic activity. And yet when they get to the moon, we find there is no volcanic activity. It's a dead world. So where did this molten rock come from? We don't know. But at the center of these circular seas, or Maria, are what they call mascons. The mascons are very heavy, dense objects of something that are somehow always at the center of these Maria. Are they some kind of ancient machine that spewed up molten rock on the surface of the moon? We don't know. We don't know what the mascons are. We don't know what the Maria is. The moon is very mysterious. Now here is some figures drawn by early man, similar to the Nazca planes, which you all are probably similar with. And on the moon, we find similar type designs. Okay, now where does that come from? Is it natural? We don't know. But we're not being told either. Always remember, NASA is short for never a straight answer. We also have what's known as the shard photograph from the lunar orbiter 111. And this thing juts up off the surface of the moon about a mile. Just like a little spindle or a tower. Is that a microwave tower? Who knows? We don't know, but it's very mysterious. We've got pictures. These are all NASA photographs, by the way. Look at this thing flitting across the surface of the moon. This thing throwing a shadow on the surface of the moon. What is this thing? And here's one jutting out over a crater. All kinds of odd stuff. People have been seeing weird things on the moon for centuries. All the way back into when they first developed telescopes, they were seeing lights moving around on the moon. They were seeing what appeared to be clouds of dust or some sort of particles moving around on the moon. You didn't get taught this in school, though, did you? And we can see in this crater some kind of weird object. Again, we see this long cigar-looking type object sitting in a crater on the moon. What is this? We don't know. Yes, I love this one. You see the tracks running along here to this little circular type object, and it's rolled along, leaving tracks on the moon. Now, my first thought was, oh well, it was up here on the top of this crater, and it rolled off and rolled down the side of the crater, which is possibly so. Now, unfortunately, this came out of a book, And the reproduction is not very good, but I've seen a clear photograph, and the tracks go down into the crater. So it rolled up the side of the crater and then down the side of the crater. Something's moving around on the moon. What is it? Don't ask me. I'm just giving you the information. More tracks on the moon. And here's an odd little X in the middle of a crater. We don't know what this is, but it's all very odd. The day before the Apollo 11 landed on the moon, the astronauts reported sighting some mysterious lunar lights in an area where scientists believe there are volcanoes. This is back when they were still saying there was volcanic activity on the moon, so it was okay to release this story. And he said it was in the crater Aristarchus, in the northeastern part of the moon's face. And astronomers have claimed observing bright spots in the area, which they appear to be volcanoes. And Buzz Aldrin said, well, the area is definitely brighter than anything else I can see. And so this has all been dutifully reported, but then it goes dark. You don't hear any more about that. So what is with the moon anyway? When I was in school, we were taught the moon broke away from the Earth. And maybe that's what created the big hole, which is now the Pacific Ocean. But now that they say we've been to the moon and we got lunar rocks and they don't match the same composition as what's on the Earth, plus they found rocks on the moon that date back before 8 billion years ago, which is older than the age of the Earth, then now it's changed. Now the idea is the capture theory, that the moon came along and was captured in the gravitational field of the Earth. Something like that, see? Well, it comes bobbing around, it gets caught, it goes back. The problem is this. If here's the Earth and here comes the moon and it's caught and it's pulled back, then the moon should be in an elliptical orbit, kind of wobbling around the Earth. But it's not. It's in a near perfect circular orbit and stationary, one side always facing the Earth. We know this, you were taught this in school, but you really hadn't ever stopped to think about it. How did it get like that? Isaac Asimov, famous science fiction writer and a very noted scientist, said the moon shouldn't be where it is. How did it get there? And, by the way, the moon is at the exact distance away from the Earth so that when there is a solar eclipse, it covers the exact circumference of the sun. You can see the corona of the sun all around it, but you can't see the sun because it's at the exact distance from the Earth where it blocks out just the exact circumference of the sun. Whoa, that's pretty precise. How does that happen naturally? The answer is, it cannot. So that means somebody parked the moon. But here we get to the conundrum of extraterrestrials, because we all know there's no such thing as extraterrestrials. But we also know that the moon is in a very unusual orbit, and somebody must have parked it there. It's been there since our recorded history, so we know we didn't do it. And so, since we know there's no such thing as extraterrestrials, how do we deal with this subject? We don't. We just don't talk about it. Okay? Go ask some of your astronomer friends, how did the moon get there? And let them start shuffling and jiving and trying to come up with an explanation, because we don't know. So apparently somebody came in and parked the moon exactly where it is, and the moon's orbit is nearly perfect circular to the Earth with only a slight wobble, which just coincidentally matches the slight wobble of the orbit of the Earth, and it's also at the equator. There also appears to be pyramids on the moon. You can see what appears to be pyramids in this crater up here, and in other areas too. Interestingly enough, the pyramids that are sighted on the moon are in the same configuration as the three major pyramids on the Giza Plateau. And if that's not odd enough, we look at Teotihuacan outside Mexico City, and if you'll simply shook that thing around, they're in the same configuration as the pyramids on the Giza Plateau. Now, how does that get to be? Something's going on here, folks. And now, of course, we see the pyramids on Mars.
Mars, yeah.
Okay? And the famous space on Mars. Now, just for you all tonight, got a special treat for you. I'm going to show you a close-up of the face on Mars. All right. Enough levity. Actually, here's the face on Mars. And then, of course, when NASA it got to be a big deal, they finally showed us this picture. Oh, yeah, well, we can really see that one. And by the way, there's been much more further work done on this. This is kind of an old slideshow. And now they've actually done computer work on it, and there's something on the face of Mars. And again, we didn't put it there, but we know there's no extraterrestrials, so let's just don't talk about that. By the way, here's another face on Mars. I think everybody can kind of see this one. And I don't know, this is in my huh file. It is possible that those are just natural formations, that you make a face out of it, kind of like you do making the face of Jesus out of a cloud or something, you know. But it's still pretty amazing. And, of course, we've got the rover Sojourner that went up there and crawled around for a few feet. And they said, see, no life on Mars. Well, excuse me, think about this. What if we lived on Mars and we sent a little rover and it landed in Antarctica and it roamed around for about 20, 30 feet? Hey, no life on the Earth. By the way, it's all changing. It's all changing. We now know there's water on the moon. We now know there's winds on the moon. We know there's water on Mars. They just were finally announcing that last week. Okay, so everything you think you know about Moon and Mars, you don't know. Because they haven't told you, and it's changing constantly. This kind of leads to the question, well, if there's ETs been around here, how long have they been here? Did our ancestors come from space? Well, you go back to the Sumerian tablets, which are probably the oldest records on the world. In fact, actually, you can go to the Hindu Vedas, and they talk about the Vayanas, flying machines that went through the air, and all their carried their gods around. And that they had, by the way, they had some sort of weaponry that could destroy a whole city with a single strike. Then you go back to the Sumerian tablets, and this was all etched in clay back about 7,000-8,000 years ago. Predates the Egyptians by 3,000 or 4,000 years. Predates the Bible by 5,000 years. And they're telling us that the Anunnaki came to the earth. Well, who's the Anunnaki? Well, that translates as those who came from the heavens to the earth. But let me clear something up here. I'm not sure if I get into this. Let me see if I get into it. There's a common theme all over the earth in all the ancient legends and stories. And the common theme is flight. The Chinese had the flying dragons. The Egyptians had the flying boats. The Sumerians had their flying disc. We all know the story of Ezekiel in the Bible as a fiery wheel. You know, if that wasn't a UFO experience, I don't know what was. And we have artifacts, anomalies, as the scientists would call them, because it doesn't conveniently fit into the little homogenized history that we've all been told. We've got these little dudes that have been found down in Colombia and dated back several thousand years. It looks like a little jet plane to me. And by the way, I don't think I have a graphic of this, but some of you have probably seen this picture. Yep. My wife and I just got back from a trip to Egypt, and in Seti's temple, up on the ceiling, you see these reliefs. And I swear to God, one of them looks like an Apache helicopter. And right next to it is a little fat jet with wings and a tail, exactly like you're seeing here. It's like, what in the world were these people drawing, you know? And is this some kind of just incredible coincidence? Or was there high technology in the ancient past? This is the Antikythera mechanism, which was discovered back about 1911 or so. It was sunk in an ancient Greek ship. They dated it back to a couple thousand years ago. And at first they didn't know what it was, but then as the years rolled on and we got kind of computer savvy, they realized it was a computer. It's got little gears within gears within gears. And it was really quite advanced. And this, of course, was made centuries before even the invention of the printing press. So we got all this stuff. The ancient Sumerians, by the way, in this relief, show us the planets of the solar system and their relative size. How'd they know all that? Pluto was only discovered in 1930 and Neptune in 1846. How did these ancient Sumerians know the makeup, composition, and relative sizes of our solar system unless they had ancient information? Other artifacts around the world are this hammer there, or this axe that was found buried in a stone, and the stone tracks back to several thousand years. You got human handprints. You all know about the human footprints down at Biloxi. Or near Glenrose, that's in the same strata with dinosaurs. Where'd that come from? You've got the round balls of Guatemala, these perfectly round balls. Try to make something round. Get you some clay and try to make by hand a perfectly round ball. You're going to have a real tough time of it, okay? And that these are, but yet these are perfectly round, and some of them are huge. Some of them are 4 to 8 feet in diameter. Where'd they come from? Who made them? We don't know. You got the Baghdad battery. They found this over in Iraq, which used to be ancient Mesopotamia, which in the Bible was called Chaldea. And by the way, the patriarch of both the Jews and the Palestinians was Abraham. And where did Abraham come from? Was he just some Semite dragging his tent through the desert? No. He came from Ur of Chaldea. Ur is one of the major cities in ancient Sumeria. He was a Sumerian. He had the knowledge, and he brought it into Egypt. And the next thing you know, there's this huge technologically advanced civilization in Egypt. So from the site of ancient cities in Iraq, the one place where you can't go now, in fact, I don't think anybody really wants to go, we found the Baghdad battery. And they didn't know what this was for a long time until somebody figured out you can put grape juice in there that's highly acidic, put the copper tube in, put the other thing in, you get a half volt of electricity. So they had electricity all the way back there. They knew about this. You don't get taught that in school, do you?
That's not there anymore.
No, it's in the museum. It's still around. It's still around. This is a 1680 French coin, and look, here's the town and steeple and countryside, and here's this giant wheel flying through the sky. They tried to tell us this for years. Everybody knew about this. They just didn't know what it was. We're the first generations who grew up with the true knowledge of space flight, cloning, genetic manipulation. We could understand all this stuff where they couldn't, but we don't get told about this. In fact, I strongly suspect that a major reason for our precipitous and unprovoked attack on Iraq was to loot the Iraqi National Museum. Because I have the stories in my files from 1999, 2000, 2001, that French and German archaeological teams were making amazing new discoveries in the ancient Sumerian cities of Uruk and Ur. And of course, where would that all be taken? To the Iraqi National Museum. And would they immediately put it on display? No. It'd be taken and stored in the basement until they could catalog it and study it, clean it all up, and prepare it for exhibition. We do know that Saddam Hussein believed himself the reincarnated Nebuchadnezzar, and that he was rebuilding Babylon. So he obviously had a great interest in all this. I find it also interesting that the two nations who most opposed our invasion of Iraq were France and Germany, who had the archaeological teams in there. And when we launched our invasion, contrary to standard military tactics, which is to go and seize your objective, hold your objective, consolidate the countryside and your winnings, and then move on to the next objective, we simply made a beeline for Baghdad. And this is why we failed to pacify the countryside, and we're still having problems. And what happened in Baghdad? The looting of the Iraqi National Museum, even though the Pentagon, at the request of rural museum directors, had pledged that we would safeguard the Iraqi National Museum because it was, after all, in the very center of the creation of the human race. Between the Tigris-Euphrates River, this is where people estimate the Garden of Eden was. This is where it all started. Western civilization started between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. And they pledged they would safeguard it. And yet, when the mobs, probably hired stooges, began to break into the museum, the U.S. military was called, a tank with some soldiers showed up, and then were ordered to withdraw. And the crowds had their way. Well, the crowds were probably a smokescreen, and there was a very systematic looting of the Iraqi National Museum. And according to Colonel Matthew Bogdanos, who investigated the museum break-in for General Tommy Franks, in an article in Archaeological Magazine, he said the basement was an inside job. They had keys to the vaults. They bypassed expensive-looking fakes. Guards were suspiciously missing that day. And they got, and then said, of all the stuff that the hired mob took out of the upper floors of the museum, a greater part of that has now been returned. I mean, that makes sense. You know, Abdul got something, went out, and what's he going to do with it? He's going to take it to the local flea market, try to get some money for it, and it will find its way back to the museum. So they've recovered most of this. But Bogdano said the basement said they haven't recovered hardly anything they took out of the basement. And what would have been in the basement?
Stargate.
The newly found stuff. Stargate, okay? Yeah. Who knows what? But they've got to have that ancient technology. And where did it come from? Didn't come from us. Oh, here is the skull of an auroch, an extinct ox, that has, for what all practical purposes, appears to be a bullet hole in it. And this ox has been dated back several thousand years, long before there were any firearms. So who knows? Are we talking about aliens? Are we talking about extraterrestrial beings? Are we talking about interdimensional beings? Or are we talking about time travelers? I don't know. All I'm trying to tell you is there's a reality here that we're not being told about. Now, between 1897 and the Aurora spaceship crash, which, by the way, while I was doing a documentary on that, a fellow showed up with his young son, and we were filming at the Wise County Courthouse. And he said, "Hey, what are you guys doing?" And I said, "Well, we're making a documentary about the spaceship crash in Aurora back in 1897. He says, "Oh, I know all about that. My grandfather was there." So I immediately had him sign a release and set him down and interview with him. And one of the interesting things that came out of this interview, because his grandfather had similar to what I'd already heard. There was an explosion. People heard it. They ran into town. There's all this metal lying around. They all picked it up, and et cetera, et cetera. But his grandfather added one little added note. He said that within hours, representatives of every law enforcement agency in Texas were showing up. I said, "Well, what did he say they did?" He said, "Well, about half of them went around saying, 'Okay, folks, go back to your home, you know, it's all over here, nothing to see.'" And the other half were loading up the metal and putting it in wagons and hauling it off. Hmm. In other words, perhaps the earliest crash retrieval. Yeah. But between 1897 and the crash retrieval at Roswell in 1947, we had the Los Angeles air raid, which I'm sure most of you have never heard about. February the 25th, 1942. Now, this is only 2 months or so after Pearl Harbor. And the West Coast was jittery, with good reason. The Hawaiian Islands had been attacked, the Sixth Fleet had been sunk, and there were reports and rumors flying that the Japanese were about to invade the West Coast at any minute. And that wasn't all just hearsay. About a month before this, in January 1942, a Japanese submarine had surfaced off the coast of California and shelled an oil refinery. So their war jitters were not entirely unjustified. On the night of February the 25th, they used one of our new secret weapons, radar. And they had just installed it there in Los Angeles. And the new radar picked up a flight of objects coming at very high speed eastward across the Pacific on a trajectory towards Los Angeles. So at about 11 o'clock at night, the air raid sirens went off. And from 11 till like 2 in the morning, there was a constant booming as the anti-aircraft guns expended thousands of rounds of ammunition. Searchlights were playing in the sky. people died. There were at least six casualties, several from heart attacks, some from car crashes, some from being hit by ordnance falling back to earth. A lot of damage to homes with, you know, you fire 1,000 rounds of anti-aircraft fire into the air, and there's pieces of junk's going to fall back down and cause some damage. Those of you who want to celebrate firing a gun in the air, remember that. Okay. The Army said this was a real alarm. But the next day, higher authorities, Harold Stimson, the Secretary of War, said, no, nothing happened, just war jitters. So it quickly dropped from the media, it dropped from everybody's memory because World War II was on. Jimmy Doolittle's raid took place shortly after this. Then, we lost the Philippines, and then et cetera, et cetera. History moved on, and everybody forgot about the Los Angeles air raid. But we still have the photographs that were made there, including this one. And some enterprising person with a computer got the photograph and simply reversed it. And, now we see that they weren't just war jitters. There really was something. These little bright spots, by the way, are just explosions from the anti-aircraft gun. Hmm. Let me go back. See?
Yeah.
That's the anti-aircraft explosions. You can almost see the object right here. But when you reverse the photograph, it's very clear. You got a saucer-shaped object. Now, furthermore, we now have these documents, which was a memo from FDR to George Marshall regarding the recovery of unconventional aircraft. As indicated in my recent memorandum to you regarding the war, the air raid over Los Angeles, it has been learned from Army GQ that Rear Admiral Anderson, with Naval Intelligence, has informed the War Department of a naval recovery of an unidentified plane off the coast of California, unlike any bearing on conventional explanation. Further, it was revealed that the Army Air Corps had recovered a similar object in the San Bernardino Mountains east of Los Angeles, which cannot be identified as conventional aircraft. So 1942, they're recovering unconventional aircraft that they know does not belong to us. And I'm sure it didn't take long to figure out it didn't belong to the Japanese either. Now, here's what's interesting. At the bottom of this memo, we see that George Marshall says, that the Chief of Staff, I have further ordered a thorough investigation of all War Department files regarding unconventional aerial phenomena reported since 1897, the very year of the Aurora spaceship crash. See how it all fits together? It's all real, folks. It's very real. Of course, you know about the Foo Fighters during World War II, and the Germans, here's a clip from the New York Times, said it's the Nazis' newest war device. And after the war, we found out the Nazis thought they were some kind of secret weapon of ours. Okay? So it didn't belong to any of us. The Japanese reported them, too, by the way. And there were reports of these fireballs in the Pacific. Now, some of these may have indeed been a Nazi secret weapon called the Feuerball, or the Fireball, which was a little device that they would put up in the bomber formations in the hopes of disrupting their electrical systems. Okay? The problem was, back then, we were using these heavily insulated wires and vacuum tubes, and they didn't really have that much effect. Today, they might really have an effect on a computer or something that's not protected. Saucers of the like. We know, and it's historic fact, that they had flying saucers on the drawing board. We've already covered some of this in the Rise of the Fourth Reich, so I'll skip on through it. We also talked about Action Adlerflug, or the Operation Eagle Flight, and how that the Nazis survived the war. Morton Bormann, who was deputy to Hitler, Hermann Schmitz, the head of IG Farben Combine, and by the way, also a man who owned as much stock in Standard Oil as John D. Rockefeller, and Dr. Hermann Joseph Abs, head of the German Central Bank, the Deutsche Bank, which is still one of the largest banks in the world and a very prominent player today. They created more than 750 corporations, in addition to about 700 corporations that they had already had set up in Switzerland, and by these German companies and involving these American companies. And it was all handled through the Bank of International Settlements, through the Deutsche Bank, Chase Bank, Union Banking Corporation, and of course, if you'll remember my talk from Rise of the Fourth Reich, who was handling the money for the Nazis through Union Banking Corporation?
Prescott
Bush. Okay, the grandfather of George W. and the father of George Herbert Walker Bush. The attorneys for the Nazi Schroeder Bank that was handling it for Baron von Schroeder, who was Alan Dulles and John Foster Dulles. Now, this is how the Nazis got a foothold in the United States after the war, because after the war, John J. McCloy, who had been head of National City Bank, which is now Citicorp, was one of the largest lenders of money to the Nazis. In fact, he sat in the same box with Hitler in the 1936 Olympics. And all of this just kept going. Business is just business.
Wasn't he at that meeting the night before JFK was assassinated up in Dallas, John J. McCloy?
That's possible. He had been in Texas along with Alan Dulles. I've seen a photograph of Alan Dulles with Lyndon Johnson taken within days of the Kennedy assassination. So they were all together. But this is another whole topic, okay? This goes back to the rise of the Fourth Reich. So let's keep moving along here. That brings us to what crashed at Roswell. That's the most famous of the crash recovery stories. But, of course, everybody, oh, gosh, it was this, it was that. No, maybe it was this. Who knows? Well, let's just look at it objectively. First off, the government has changed its story four times. Right off the bat, the base commander, Colonel Butch Blanchard, authorized the release of a news release that said, "We have captured a flying saucer." Okay? Higher authorities, General Ramey, over the 6th Air Force, I guess it was, out of Carswell, said, No, they got it all wrong. It was not a flying saucer. It was just a weather balloon. They just mistook a weather balloon for this flying saucer. Now, let me point out a few things here. Number one, the 509th Bomb Group at Roswell Army Airfield in New Mexico was the only unit in the U.S. military at that time equipped with nuclear weapons. They were the group that dropped the atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. These were the first-string guys. These were the best military people we had. And Major Marcel, who was their intelligence officer, had been on Tinian and had been involved in the bombings of Hiroshima, Nagasaki. And to tell us that these guys couldn't tell a flying saucer from balloon wreckage is an affront to your sensibilities. They're insulting your intelligence. And if that doesn't prove something to you, then how many of you guys been in the military? Anybody? Butch, good. Me too. Now, you know, in the military, the surefire way to advancement is very simple. Don't screw up. Okay? Don't screw up. If you mind your P's and Q's, follow your orders, then chances are you can advance. Colonel Blanchard, okay, he authorized the release, said, "We've captured a flying saucer." And then they came back, our authorities, and said, no, it was just a weather balloon. He screwed up. Okay? Either it was a flying saucer and they didn't want that information out, which means he really messed up, or it really was a huge cock-up and it was a weather balloon, in which case he screwed up too. So, in the military, you know that if you mess up like that, his next assignment should have been Nome, Alaska, okay? That should have been the last we ever heard of Colonel Blanchard. Au contraire, Colonel Blanchard went on to become the second youngest brigadier general in U.S. military history, second only to George Custer. And Custer's advancement to colonel had been a mistake. Okay? And at the time of his death in the late 60s, Blanchard, General Blanchard, had been sent to Vietnam to write an overall report on our status in the Vietnam War. Whoa! This guy was a credible and promoted military leader. So in other words, when he said, "We've captured a flying saucer," he was telling the truth. And when he backed off and followed orders and said, "No, it was just a weather balloon," he was following orders. So he gets promoted. That's the way it works.
Now, when all of this came about 1996 or so, the Air Force finally issued this report, the Roswell report, stamped case closed. Does that sound familiar? They always say case closed. This is the final word. And in their background, they say, this comprehensive further examination, so-called Roswell incident, found no evidence whatsoever, flying saucer, space aliens, citizen government cover-up. By the way, that's interesting. They use the same verbiage as the Warren Commission. The Warren Commission never said there was no conspiracy to kill Kennedy. What they said over and over and again was, we could find no evidence of conspiracy. And of course they didn't, because they didn't go look for it. In fact, they systematically turned away any and didn't look at any evidence supporting the conspiracy. Same thing here. We could find no evidence of space aliens. Well, of course not. You can't get to it. Barry Goldwater tried to go to Wright Patterson, see if he could get in to view the space aliens. They wouldn't even let him in. You think they're going to let the guys writing this report in? But here's the clincher. By the time this report came out, they changed their story again. They said, okay, it really wasn't a weather balloon. We lied about that because it was a secret mogul balloon. Now, the mogul balloon was not even secret. A mogul balloon was a weather balloon, basically. The only thing classified about mogul was that it carried this very sensitive testing equipment into the upper atmosphere to test, and they were testing to see if the Soviets were setting off nuclear weapons. Now, don't ask me why they thought they had to send up balloons from New Mexico to see what the Soviets in Russia were setting off, when they could have sent those balloons off from Turkey or Japan or any number of places much closer to the Soviet Union, because I don't know, and they never explained. But so the only thing secret and classified about the mogul balloons was simply the information, the software that they were carrying. I might also point out that in one book written by a very pro-mogul balloon explanation for Roswell, he went a little overboard and he actually gave every little statistical bit of information about the mogul balloon, and he pointed out that of 22 releases of these mogul balloons, they only recovered 8. Why such a low number? Because, as he pointed out himself, they didn't bother to go look for any more. Well, how classified is that? You don't even bother to go look for them. But then that didn't really satisfy anybody, so by 1997 they had added something else, and that was crash dummies. What they saw was crash dummies. Now, here's a picture, and by the way, this is Raymond Madsen right here with his arm around one of the crash dummies. He was part of the crash dummy program, and I talked to Mr. Madsen, and he laughed at the whole idea that what they had seen in 1947 was crash dummies, because as you can obviously see, they look like humans. They weigh the same as humans. It only makes sense if you're testing parachutes or ejection seats or whatever. You don't want a little 4-foot alien-looking guy. You want some guy that weighs and looks like a human. Plus, he said that you wouldn't have any trouble identifying them. He said because one of the problems they had was that when they parachute these crash dummies out, the wind currents would catch them and scatter them all over the countryside. So they said on front and back, they had a big stencil that says, property of U.S. Air Force, $25 reward if you'll bring you back in, you know. None of that was found on whatever it was they found at Roswell. But here's the clincher. Obviously, you can see there's a whole lot of difference between a 4-foot big-headed alien and a 6-foot, 200-pound crash dummy. But in this same Roswell report, where they're trying to tell us it's just crash dummies, they thoughtfully gave us a listing of the high-altitude balloon dummy drops. The very first one took place on June the 23rd, 1954. Now, that leads me to recall when they had a press conference in summer of 1997, and Colonel Johnson got up and explained that what they'd seen was crash dummies, and then he began to and commenced to show some old news footage of the crash dummies and some of the planes that were carrying them. And after he got through with his presentation and went to questions from the media, one of the more astute reporters said, Colonel Johnson said, you're telling us this is what they saw in 1947. Said, but you're showing us data and photographs that are obviously from the 1950s and 60s. And they came back to Johnson. You know what he said? I remember his words distinctly. He said, well, I really don't know what they saw in 1947. And I thought, well, then why are you having this news conference?
Yeah.
And why are we listening to you? But this is what's going on, folks. And, of course, here's General Ramey right here with his weather officer holding some weather balloon debris. And I talked to Bon Johnson, who was a reporter, a photographer for the Star-Telegram at that time. And he is convinced, because he was there, they started to let him in, they suddenly rushed, pushed them all out of the room, held them around for a while, then let them back in, and here was Ramey, and here was the weather guy with his junk, and it didn't look like the same stuff they'd seen the first time. And he is still, to this day, convinced that they swapped the wreckage for this balloon debris, okay? But another thing is that when they took this, allowed these pictures to be made of them holding the balloon wreckage, you notice in Ramey's hand is a telegram. Now, this is a picture that was published in a book, and it's, you know, third, fourth generation and out of the book and pretty hazy, but they've gotten hold of the original print of this, and thanks to computer digitization, they were able to blow up this telegram to the point to where they can read some of the words on it. And it says, bodies, crash site, retrieval, okay? Something very totally different than the story that it was just a crashed weather balloon. Of course, in 1947, General Ramey would have never, in his wildest dreams, thought that in the future that high school kids would have computers and could analyze this photograph enough to be able to read the message on the telegram. Amazing. So now, though, we have, here's a partial list of people who have now spoken out and said, I was there, I saw the debris, I picked up the bodies, I carried the bodies to Roswell Army Air Force, I put them in boxes, I guarded the boxes, I loaded the boxes on aircraft, I flew the aircraft to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, yada, yada, yada. So, and also, we now have documents that have now given us a pretty good view of what actually happened, including July the 3rd, radar stations in West Texas, White Sands Proving Ground, track two identified aircraft until both dropped off radar. The two crash sites have been located close to White Sands Proving Ground. Site landing zone one was located at a ranch near Corona, approximately 75 miles northwest of the town of Roswell. Site landing zone two was located approximately 20 miles southeast of the town of Socorro, at latitude 33, 40, 31, longitude blah, blah, blah. So in other words, there were two crash sites. Now this accounts for some of the confusion. People have argued, oh, it was a Corona, and others have argued, no, it was at Roswell. What apparently happened was this is all part of the same crash. The thing hit the ground, bam, and lost a lot of debris. This was the debris field. But then the major portion of it, or at least the flight compartment, the command deck ricocheted and went way on over and ended up in a gully near Socorro. And this is reportedly where the bodies were found. So that's caused confusion, the fact that they've argued over, was it this crash site or that crash site, and actually it's all part of the same crash. Interestingly enough, and this document is dated 1947, on arrival at landing zone 2, that would be the command module, personnel assessed the finds as not belonging to any aircraft, rocket, weapons, or balloon tests that are normally conducted from surrounding bases. First reports indicated the first crash investigators from Roswell that landing zone 1 was the remains of an Army Air Force top secret Mogul balloon. So originally they thought it was a Mogul balloon. But when scientists from Los Alamos Scientific Laboratory arrived to inspect landing zone 2, it became apparent to all concerned that what had crashed in the desert was something out of this world. And they say, well, where's the pieces? Well, there are even pieces now that have been studied that they claim come from Roswell. And they contain bismuth, zinc, and I've held some of this in my own hand. It's obviously manufactured. This is not natural formations. They're layered, okay? And they've not been able to trace this to any manufacturing process known on the earth. So don't let anybody tell you that there's no hard evidence. Admittedly, these are little bitty pieces because where's the ship? Where's the body? They took them all away. They hid them away. So, with Roswell, it comes down to an article of faith. Do you want to believe the U.S. Air Force report with little or no documentation that says nothing happened? A few various debunkers with no firsthand information, or the news media, which has no real knowledge of the issue? Or do you want to believe the initial press release, more than 400, it's now 600 witnesses on the public record, thousands of leaked government documents, radar contacts, unknown bits of metal, and the fact that they went around making death threats to U.S. citizens in the wake of this Roswell incident? I don't care how important the mobile balloon was, it would have never justified telling police officers and even a 15-year-old girl that if you talk about this, they're going to be finding your bones out in the desert. I'm sorry, but there's no excuse for that kind of secrecy. Not in a democratic, free country, no matter how damaging the information may be. Let me tell you how to handle that. During World War II, the Japanese were testing what they call fuego balloons or fire balloons, and they would launch these balloons from way up north, and they would drift across the Pacific and mostly come into the Pacific Northwest. And they were timed so that at a certain time they would break loose and they drop firebombs. And the idea was to set big forest fires up in the Northwest to just confuse us, confound us, tie up men and material. One of them landed all the way like into Kansas or somewhere. A female reporter found out about it, went out, was on the scene, and said, boy, have I got a good story. We found this Japanese fire balloon here in Kansas. The FBI went to her and said, lady, if you run this story, the Japanese will be able to know where this balloon landed. They'll be able to calculate how effective the balloon was and what the wind currents are and everything else, and you're going to be giving aid and comfort to our enemy in a time of war. And she said, okay. And she did not publish the story until after the war. Now, that's the way you handle a secret. You don't make death threats against the civilian population. So, what do you want to believe? Did it happen or it didn't happen? It's up to you. All I can say is, the government says it didn't happen. Now, do we trust the government? How many times have they lied to us? I lost count. I didn't say this. I want to be a true blue American. And I was in the Army. But I remember taking that oath. And I swore to protect not the president, not the Congress, not the state of Texas. I swore to protect the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign or domestic. And these are domestic enemies. We know about Colonel Carso. He found whistleblowers. There, the whistleblowers are all over the place. You would have heard more except for the control media and except for the fact that so many of them are hesitant to speak out because many of them did sign secrecy oaths, and the people who reach rank in the military are generally men of honor and integrity. And when they pledge that they'll not talk about something, then generally they don't. The onus does not lie with them. The onus lies with the people who made them promise to be secret about what is probably the most stupendous story in the history of the human race. And they're supposed to shut up about it. Even astronauts have said that we have gained material based on crashed alien vehicles. Where it all came down, and this was the start of the whole problem we have, was the National Security Act of 1947. Now, before 1947, there had been a little talk about changing the name from the War Department to the Defense Department. Well, that's a little public relations move. Nobody wants to think they're supporting the war, but everybody wants to support defense. That's just PR. Okay, and there had been talk about separating the Air Force from the Army. It used to be the Army Air Corps, you know. And there had been talk about coordinating the intelligence services through a central intelligence agency to prevent duplication of effort with the Naval Intelligence, Army Intelligence, Air Force Intelligence. But what really got the ball rolling was Roswell. Immediately after the crash at Roswell, which is early July 1947, immediately they began to quickly put together the National Security Act of 1947 to rush into law. And in September of 1947, Harry Truman, who was president, was trying to get home to visit his mother, who was dying, and they held him at National Airport for hours until they could rush out this National Security Act to get his signature on it so that, bam, they could make it into law. Why the rush? And what did it do? It separated the Air Force from the Army, created the Air Force branch, we know that. It renamed the War Department to the Defense Department. It created the CIA, which has been the bane of our existence ever since. But what a lot of people miss is probably the most important facet of the National Security Act of 1947. It created the National Security Council. And if you'll think about it, everything from Vietnam to the invasion of Panama to the invasion of that island down in the Caribbean, whose name escapes me at the moment, Grenada, to everything else going on is all the National Security Council. And what did I just tell you? Barack Obama's National Security Advisor said there's a command chain that still exists in the National Security Council. The Iran-Contra scandal. Colonel North, who's admitted he lied to Congress and hence lied to the American public. But he said, but I had full approval of the president. Problem is, he didn't say which president. Everybody thought he meant President Reagan. But it turns out that all the documents signed on the Iran-Contra scandal were all signed by Vice President Bush. So Bush had been giving us trouble all along. But it's all done under the National Security Council, because anything that smacks of national security obviously would come under the purview of the National Security Council. This, my friends, is when they bypassed the Constitution, the Congress, the news media, and the American public. This is when the shadow government came into being. This is exactly what happened. And, of course, one of the items they had to keep secret was UFOs. And this is still being held within the technology committee or whatever they want to call it of the National Security Council. And who's in charge of that? I've already told you. Henry Kissinger, for God's sakes. Okay? And this is where the secret has been held all this time. A secret that you, all your neighbors, everyone on earth should know about. What's the secret? We are not alone. Okay? For better or for worse. Who knows? We could argue all night over whether are they good or they bad or whatever. We're getting some of that. They immediately created Majestic 12. Here are the original members. Okay? One of them, James Forrestal, our very first Secretary of Defense, apparently didn't go along with this program because they said, well, he's got a mental problem. They put him in Bethesda Naval Hospital and he either fell or was pushed out a 17th-story window. But we now find out, and all these documents have leaked out, including this manual, Extraterrestrial Entities and Technology Recovery and Disposal, Standard Operating Manual 101, all right? Press blackout. Never let the press know what's going on. This all stems back to early 50s. 1952, when flying saucers came over Washington, they were, and at that time, everybody in the city could see them. The news media rushed out to National Airport and were going to take pictures of the radar screens that were picking them up, and they got chased out. National security. And then later, we were told it was just temperature inversion.
Swamp gas.
Now, one of the reasons for this secrecy was because they commissioned the Brookings Institution to do a study to try to figure out what happens if a less advanced culture comes into contact with a more technological advanced culture. So the Brookings Institution went back. All they had to work with was history. So they went back and said, well, they said Earth civilization may topple if faced by a race of superior beings. Okay? In other words, man, stock market could crash. You know? We might lay, you know, and here's the clincher. What was left unsaid, because the true rulers in this country, and I'm not talking about the president or the congressman, or I'm talking about the people who run the banks, people who own the banks, the people who own the Federal Reserve System, I'm talking about the people who really run this country. They owe their wealth and their power to their monopolies over energy, medicine, telecommunications, transportation. Okay?
And drugs.
They don't really, drugs, of course. They don't really care if you know that there's extraterrestrials out there. Obviously, I mean, Star Trek, Star Wars, The X-Files. By the way, a new movie out right now, Race to Witch Mountain, go see it. Pretty good. It's really interesting. The DODs, the bad guys, the aliens are the good guys, and it shows, it kind of makes fun of the UFO crowd, and yet, if you think about it at the end of the program, it's, well, those guys were right. So, we're in a reverse conditioning process now. But anyway, yeah, they don't care if you know about aliens, but if you know beyond any shadow of a doubt that extraterrestrials exist, then you know beyond any shadow of a doubt that there is alternative technology. And you're not going to sit still for $4 a gallon gasoline prices and for this crappy drugs that they're pushing off on everybody, and et cetera, et cetera. That's the reason for the secrecy. But they used the Brookings Institution report for a good number of years to say we can't release this to the public or they'll panic, you know. And you know what? Actually, I'll try to give the devil his due. There is some reason for that. In 1947 or by 1950, this was only 10 years or so more since the famous War of the Worlds broadcast by Orson Welles, 1938. And number one, I don't think it's really proper to judge that against a calm and reasoned release of information. In other words, Orson Welles, some of you are probably very familiar with it, some of you are not. In 1938, Orson Welles took H.G. Wells' book, The War of the Worlds, and dramatized it on the Mercury Theater of the Air on radio, which was a national radio broadcast. And they did it like it was a live report, okay? And at the very beginning of the program, they said, hey, happy Halloween. Here's a program to scare you. And this is all just made up. And, you know, have a happy Halloween. But then they started on the program, and you'd hear dance music. And they said, we interrupt this program to bring you a news flash from New Jersey. These soldiers have landed, and something seems to be coming out. A few minutes later, you go back to music. They said, we break in again. Those cylinders, something's coming out of the cylinders, and they're blowing up whole cities, and people are dying. Oh, my God, the humanity, you know. Well, no wonder people panic. You know, they turn in a little bit late. They didn't get the word that this wasn't real. And they didn't have other channels to go to like we do now. Those of you who are my age or so might recall at the time of the Kennedy assassination, you turn on every radio station, every TV station, what did you get? The Kennedy assassination. They preempted everything. 9/11 wasn't even that way. 9/11, all the news channels and all the broadcast channels were all talking about 9/11, but you could still turn to cable and satellite, you can watch a movie and you can act like it wasn't happening. So, but back then in radio, that's all they had. So yes, there was a lot of people who panicked and stampeded. And this was not lost on these people. So between the Brookings Institution report and the recent memory, there might have been some reason at that point to at least play down the idea of extraterrestrial visitation. But the time has long passed.
We've all grown up with Star Wars, Star Treks. You ask any
young person today, what about ETs? And they go, yeah, so what? You know,
they're used to it.
But all the way back there in 1952, they instituted a policy of control and denial with an added factor of ridicule. You didn't see anything, and if you keep saying you did, then you probably need psychological counseling. And this has been extremely effective in keeping this whole topic off the table. This is why in 1997, when I published Alien Agenda, which was nothing but a report on what was available to the public about UFOs and extraterrestrials, I'm boycotted. I'm shunned. That's why Kevin doesn't even want to be associated with anybody that talked about UFOs. Nobody in the media today wants to touch it. But thankfully, it is now changing. And again, let me reemphasize, if you dismiss the topic of UFOs and extraterrestrials, you'll never figure out what's really going on in the world, because you're throwing out a very big and important piece of the puzzle. Did Kennedy know about all this? The tabloids reported that he was shot to keep from revealing to the people that the reality of UFOs. Now, when I first heard this back in the 70s, I snickered and I said, no way. But yet, there may be a modicum of truth to this. Because we found from the Counterintelligence Corps report of 1947, way back at the back, it states that it has become known to counterintelligence that some of the recovery operation was shared with Representative John F. Kennedy, Massachusetts Democrat, elected to Congress in 46, son of Joseph P. Kennedy, who was on the Commission of Organization of the Executive Branch of the government. Kennedy had limited duty as a naval officer assigned to naval intelligence during the war, and is believed that the information was obtained from a source in Congress who was close to the Secretary of the Air Force. How many of you knew that John F. Kennedy had been with naval intelligence? Not very many. But he was. And I won't go into that whole story. That's inconvenient. You know that. But that's true. So this is a true remark, and this is true information. So that tells us that John F. Kennedy in 1947 was one of the few people who knew that Roswell was real. So that brings us to 1961. June, where he is ordering, he wants a brief summary of your, at your earliest convenience, a review of MJ-12 intelligence operations. Uh-oh, he wants to know about MJ-12. He wants to know about the most secret thing we had going, because MJ-12 was in charge of UFOs.
Whose signature was that at the bottom?
That's John F. Kennedy's. That's his signature. Now, Glenn Pace and Rufus Bond in 1963 were photographers working at what is now Area 51. I think they were calling it Groom Lake at the time. Now, they didn't have access to any alien technology or any UFO secrets, but they did share a lunchroom with some of the Nazi scientists who were still there working and who probably did have access to some of our most secret UFO information. And they tell the story that in the spring or early summer of 1963, because it had to be before the Marilyn Monroe memo, they said these German scientists and these other scientists that had been working at the very top secret levels at Area 51 were laughing and snickering because they said the president was going to come for a visit. And the idea was, we'll give him the usual dog and pony show and tell him there's nothing here and buy him a lunch and he'll go away. Then they said that after the presidential visit in this lunchroom, everybody was scowling and cursing and saying, he's going to cut our budget. And obviously the visit was not a pleasant experience. So apparently what happened was, Kennedy shows up, they give him the usual runaround, nothing here, Mr. President. But based on that document from 1947, he knew better. So he says, you're lying to me, I'm going to cut your budget. And I'm going to regain control over this whole thing. So now we find that on November the 12th, less than a month before he's killed in Dallas, he issues this directive to the Director of Central Intelligence, a review of all UFO intelligence files. He said, as I was discussed with you previously, I've initiated and have instructed James Webb, who at that time was head of NASA, to develop a program with the Soviet Union in joint space and lunar exploration. And it would be very helpful if you would have the high threat cases reviewed for the purpose of identification of bona fide as opposed to classified CIA and UFO sources. It's important that we make a clear distinction between the knowns and the unknowns in the event the Soviets try to mistake our extended cooperation as a cover for intelligence gathering of their defense and space programs. Now, number one, 1963, and Kennedy was going to have joint space exploration, and he demands all the UFO files out of the CIA. He would have made it public. He was shaking it all up. And this same document that I retrieved out of the Kennedy Library shows that he has sent a memorandum to James Webb, the administrator for NASA, and he says, basically he's telling him to cooperate with the Soviet joint space exploration. Now, in 1963, most of y'all don't remember 1963, but you remember the Reagan years, the evil empire? We were still in a Cold War in the 1980s. Kennedy was trying to end it, and he was going into joint space exploration. That should have been a huge story, but nobody ever got told about this, okay? And by the way, all this has been totally confirmed by Nikita Khrushchev's son, who said, yes, he knew all about this. They were getting ready to go and end the Cold War. And if they had turned over UFO information to the White House, it would have leaked, it would have all come out. But before the month was out, Kennedy was shot in the head.
Covering up LBJ's scowling face there with that article?
Yeah, that's a great picture. LBJ's looking at him like, your time is coming. Okay, this is an interesting sidelight. In the mid-50s, 1954, this was 3 years before the Soviets put Sputnik in orbit, it was announced in the New York Times and various other publications. I couldn't believe this when I was researching for my book, Alien Agenda, so I went and looked it all up. It was in Time, Newsweek. They said they had just discovered two giant satellites orbiting the Earth at the equator. One of them was 600 miles out, one of them was 800 miles out, and they were traveling about 18,000 miles an hour. And they got the famous astronomer Clyde Tombaugh, to set up a satellite watch system. They wanted, and they was while they were publicizing this, they wanted everybody in the world to set up their telescopes and help them spot these two satellites that were revolving around the Earth. And then some scientists were theorizing that they could use them as a stepping stone to the moon. In other words, they launch a rocket, they land on the first satellite, launch a rocket, land on the second one, and then use that one to go on out into space and go to the moon, okay? And then all reports on this stop because they went away. Think about it, folks. What naturally could come into orbit around the Earth and then go away? It was all there, but you don't get told about this, so it didn't happen. Dropped in the old memory hole. Then we have, on December the 9th, 1949, a Japanese astronomer looked through his telescope at what appeared to be a giant explosion took place on Mars. The blast was followed by a luminescent cloud estimated 40 miles high. Now, what was that all about? That was all about because, again, it was reported that right after we had set off the nuclear bombs in Japan, they got the bright idea of maybe we could tell what other worlds are like by shooting a nuclear bomb up to Mars and setting it off, and then we could study the cloud formations and the dust and everything else. And there's no hard evidence to show that this happened, but you've got this astronomer who saw this giant explosion in 1949, and could this be one reason that the ETs came around? You know, what would you do if your neighbors started shooting, RPG rockets into your front yard? You'd go over to find out what was up, right? What are you doing? And this is, I think, in this theory, This is what happened when we set off the first atomic explosions, because when you set off a nuclear explosion, you're tampering with the basic molecular structure of the universe, and it goes far beyond just the immediate area of the blast. You got energy perturbations that go out through the entire universe. And I think somewhere somebody said, holy crap, the kids found the matches. And they came to find out what was going on, because 1946, you had the fireballs over Sweden, 1947, you got the Roswell crash, plus a spate of flying saucer stuff, and it continued unabated. By the way, just something else too, and this is a semi-theory. The facts are correct, but my conclusion, I'll have to admit, is just based on common sense. About 1952, the Air Force issued directives to shoot down any UFO. If you see them, shoot them. And over the next year, there was a huge spate of airline crashes. They were just dropping out of the sky. You can go back and check the record. And then the Air Force backed off and sent out a new directive and said, if you see a UFO, track it, follow it, but don't shoot at it. And the airline crashes stopped.
Yeah.
Were we in a little subtle war with them? And did they let us know that, hey, you shoot at us, we can take care of you? Interesting.
Very.
Abductions. Cattle mutilations. With cattle mutilations, the human abduction thing we'll save for later. There are literally thousands of people who claim that they've been abducted by aliens, and they all can't be nuts. Dr. John Mack at the, we'll just look at him, unfortunately got killed, run over by a driver in England. And by the way, for you conspiracy-minded people, I looked into that quite carefully, and I think it was truly an accident. Because the guy that hit Mack stopped, tried to give him aid. And let me tell you something, I almost got run over in England too, because they drive on the wrong side of the road. And you go up there and you look and you don't see anybody, so you start to walk across and they're coming this way at you, okay? So, but it was very unfortunate, because Dr. John Mack was a very distinguished Harvard academic, and who made a very, very thorough study and concluded, based on all of his work, that these abductions are real, and that the only logical explanation was that these people had had face-to-face experiences with extraterrestrials. He got in trouble for this, of course. And they had a peer review there at Harvard, and everybody was going, oh my gosh, he's going to get kicked out. They went back and they said, we're not even going to rule on what he's talking about aliens or whatever. We're simply looking at his methodology. And what the peer review panel came to was that his methodology was solid. Well, that's about as close as you can come to saying, yeah, he's right. And it's unfortunate that we lost this thing. Cattle mutilations. Going back to the time I worked at the Star Telegram, we were having cattle mutilations all around here. And folks, they're still happening today. Still going on, but you don't read about it because the paper doesn't report on it. Typical deal. Well, yeah, it happened, but hey, that's old news. Well, who's behind it? We don't know. Well, then we don't want to run the story. And here just shows the years they've happened all over the United States and actually all over the world. They cover many countries, many years, surgical precision, only at night. And I talked to Gabe Valdez. And he says it's hard to believe that predators can pull a steer's heart out through a small hole in its neck. And I've seen that. Damn. I went to the one and only cattle mutilation conference in New Mexico back about 1979. And this place was packed with ranchers, farmers, law enforcement people from all around the country. And they were dead serious. They wanted to know what was going on. And a guy named Rommel, an FBI official, gets up before anything can be said and says, gentlemen, I'd like to tell you that we asked you not to say anything that might be used in a future court case. Well, of course, they catch somebody. They got everything they know. It could be, and so they all admitted, they said, we've been muzzled. Yeah. And that was the end of that. So they keep the lid on, and they don't tell you about all this. It's still going on. It's not getting reported on. I myself held in my hand some color slides made by Arkansas State patrolmen who've gone out to a cattle mutilation. This is simulated, just so you can see what I'm talking about. They had gone out to a typical cattle mutilation and had treated it like a crime scene. And they took 35 millimeter camera and they made color slides. And then when they went back and didn't notice anything out of the ordinary other than the precision surgically cut holes in the cow and the fact that soft tissue had been removed, they went back, developed it, turned it into slides, and said when they looked at it, they were astounded because you could clearly see a cone of blue light rising out of the side of the cow and then just stopping. Well, how do you stop light? That's pretty odd in itself. And folks, I've seen this. I held those slides in my house and in my hands and looked at them. And they said, what's this? So they figured, well, something's wrong with the camera, or we have bad film. So they took the camera apart, worked on it, got it where they knew it was okay, then got new film, went out there. They couldn't see anything at the scene. Take pictures. They go back. There's the blue cone of light. Amazing. Something's going on beyond our ken. What's going on with cattle mutilations? Now, okay, this is, again, kind of falls under theory, but it's informed theory. At the A&M, it was reported that humans share many of their innermost genetic secrets represented by perfect match chromosomes with another mammal, cows. We have 23 chromosomes in our DNA makeup. They have 23. And as they say, you are what you eat. And we eat a lot of beef, right? Now, think about it. If somebody wanted to come and cut open some earth creatures to find out how bad pollution was getting, wouldn't it be better to leave a few mutilated cows around than a whole thousands of mutilated humans? So the thing is that I found out in my research of looking into the animal mutilation is there's two things. Every time you had animal mutilations, you had UFO reports. Every time you had cattle mutilations and UFO reports, you had reports of strange blacked out helicopters with no markings, strange trucks roaring up and down the backcountry roads. So it became obvious to me that the two were intertwined. So where we are is either the cattle mutilations are being conducted by ETs and the U.S. government is secretly chasing around after them to figure out what they're up to, or the cattle mutilations are being conducted by the U.S. government with the ETs chasing around, trying to see what they're up to. I personally suspect it's the former, although I think some of those mutilations probably were committed by the government, but simply in copycat manner to try to figure out what are they doing and what are they doing. They're taking sex orgy and they're taking the soft tissue. This is where pollution would gather the strongest and the most. This is how they could determine what the ecology of the planet is doing. And of course, you know about crop circles, but I'll just kind of skim on through this pretty quick. Crop circles are amazing, and we find that, number one, they're very often associated with sacred sites. That's Stonehenge. Right across the way is one of my favorite crop circles. It's made up of 140 circles. Now, look at that. Just look at it for a minute. And you tell me if two guys with a board and some string did that.
September
11th. Yeah. Yeah. They finally said it was Doug and Dave, these two pub crawlers over in England. Once the story about the crop circles just grew and grew, and even the establishment media was beginning to talk about it, okay, then all of a sudden Doug and Dave came forward and said, oh, it was us. We go down to the pub, we get a little loaded, we go out with a string. We're tromping all around, you know, and the media bought it, okay, just like they bought Phoenix. Oh, it was military flares. Yeah, it was military flares. They dropped them at 10:30 at night, but that doesn't explain what flew over Phoenix at 8:30, okay? So then they let the whole thing drop. They didn't have sense enough, the media did, to go back and simply check the record. The very year that Doug and Dave was public and said, yeah, we hoaxed 200 crop circles. If they'd simply gone and done their homework, they would have found there were 2,000 crop circles. and that they covered not only England, but America, Canada, Australia, okay? So what, Doug and Dave are flying all over the place? Of course, you don't hear about Doug and Dave anymore because I forget, one of them, I forget, Doug maybe, he died. So it wasn't. So Dave couldn't go out there and do it all by himself now. Are there hoax crop circles? Yes, there are. And but they go back through history. Here's a woodcut from talking about the mowing devil. So it's nothing really that new. Here's another incredibly complex crop circle. I think I actually figured out what they're all about. They're intergalactic corporate logos. Yeah, it does. It looks like the trilateral logo, doesn't it? But it's easy enough to tell a legitimate crop circle from a hoax crop circle. Are there hoax crop circles? Yeah, there are. In fact, now there's groups of people over in England who get their jollies going out and trying to hoax as complicated a crop circle as they do. But it's really simple to tell a real one from a fake one. In the fake ones, they do exactly what you'd expect. They go out with a board and a string, and they go in a circle, and they tromp down the crop, whether it's corn or whether it's grape or rapeseed, whatever. And as you would expect, the crop is mashed, the stems are broken, the leaves are stripped off, so it's easy to tell that. In a real crop circle, the plants lay down, but they don't die. They keep growing, but they will never stand up again. And they go in a swirl, and sometimes they're braided. And they're in layers, and one layer will grow clockwise, the layer on top of them will be counterclockwise. What can do that? We don't know, but certainly not anything human. And you can tell because here are normal wheat nodes, and the ones, and I've got some of these in my possession, the nodes on the crop circles are blown out, kind of like popcorn, as though they have been exposed to intense microwave energy. Same thing that happens to that popcorn in your microwave. And here we see the crop that has been bent over, but it's still living, but it just can't stand up again. This has all been thoroughly documented by Dr. Livingood. We also find that they found a Euclidean theory expressed in the crop circles that is not known to humans. Nobody had ever done that before. And they don't tell you about the best ones, such as this one at Chilbolton in 2001. Here's the Chilbolton radio telescope. In 1974, we sent this into space, which is a binary code that tells us that here's some binary numbers. That's telling the atomic elements. This tells us, gives us in binary code the makeup of human DNA. This gives a little body of a human, and this tells our solar system with the Earth. Offset, so it shows we come from the third planet from our sun, okay? And in 2001, we get this sent back in the field across from the Chilbolton radio telescope. That's see the wheel tracks. Those are crop, but it's not real high. And they show us that they come from the third, fourth, fifth, and I guess sixth planets of their system. And look at their little figure. Big head, little bitty body, and the DNA is slightly different. So did we get an answer back? Well, if we did, we're not being told about it. And wow, here, did they show us who's sending it? This is a hoax one, okay? Everybody got excited when they saw this one, then ran out. Of course, it's all trampled down. It's obviously a hoax one. But that one's not. And this one came along with a face. Isn't that interesting? But in 2002, we got this one with a face and a formation that is in code, binary numbers, and it is translated as, "Beware the bearers of false gifts and their broken promises. Much pain, but still time. Believe there is good out there. We oppose deception. Conduit closing. And that's the last one we've gotten like that. So I guess the conduit closed. Now the question is, who are they talking about? The bearers of false gifts and their broken promises. Could it be the ETs that have made deals with our military-industrial complex? Could it be the ETs that were in touch with the Nazis and gave them superior technology? We don't know. One of the reasons we don't know is because there's been these conditioning programs. Now, let me explain what I'm talking about. In 1998, as they were clearing the Amazon rainforest, they discovered the Carubos, a Stone Age tribe. In the past, we were rushed in there, said, here, put some clothes on, and by the way, here's a Bible. And, you know, and the tax man will be right along. But this time, we had progressed, and we had become a little more sophisticated, and so we cordoned off the area and embargoed that whole area. Not to keep them in, but to keep everybody else out. We quarantined them. And then we sent in a team of anthropologists who, over time, allowed themselves to be seen. They'd be up on a mountain and they'd wave to them, you know, and then they'd get a little closer, be down to the middle of the mountain and wave at them. And finally, they're across the clearing from them and they wave at them. And they got them used, they conditioned them to the fact that they were there and that they were friends. And finally, they made contact. And then, and only then, the only thing they did was give them some metal knives to improve their lot in life, but not enough that would totally disrupt and destroy their culture, because we wanted to study them to find out how Stone Age people lived. Folks, I submit to you, the same thing is happening to us. They are letting themselves be seen, they are letting themselves be known, and we are in a conditioning process so that we, and it's working, because in the 50s, national polls showed that virtually no one believed there was any life outside of the Earth. Okay? Today, the polls show quite the opposite. Today, 85% or higher said, yeah, there's probably life out there. So that's been a very effective conditioning process over about the past 50, 60 years. Now the danger is coming in. Because now the danger is, now that we're all becoming aware that, yeah, there could be life out there, and that's okay. Now the danger is that our military-industrial complex, who is capable of pulling off events like 9/11 using non-public technology so that everyone understands that it was an inside job and nobody quite, and we're all arguing over exactly what caused it all. What caused all the destruction of that concrete? What could bring these modern buildings down into their own footprint? You know, what could destroy those 47 steel girders in the middle of the buildings? We argue fire, thermite, everything, space beam weapons, who knows? And all of it sounds ridiculous, and we're all fighting among ourselves, and nothing's getting decided, okay? And they can use this same technology to simulate a threat from space. And this is not my theory, okay? This goes back to the early 70s when Carol Rosen, who went on to become the first woman executive of Fairchild Industries, was working with Dr. Wernher von Braun, that highly decorated Nazi who came over here and became the father of our space program. And he told her back in the early 70s that the enemy du jour of today is the communist. He said, it's all a lie. He said, when that doesn't work anymore, it's going to be terrorist, probably centered in the Middle East. He said, but that's a lie. He said, when that no longer works, and it's getting a little thin right now, isn't it? We're all kind of going, wait a minute, you know, why are we losing all our liberties? Why are we losing our daughters and our sons over in Iraq and Afghanistan? I mean, where's Osama anyway, you know? And so it's wearing thin now. He said the next one will be a threat from space. Exactly what Ronald Reagan spoke about in front of the United Nations. And see, that's what's kept modern presidents in line. Reagan might have been an okay guy, but they tell Reagan, listen, we've got to keep all this secret because if it all comes out, it's going to be disruption, the stock market will crash, the economy will fail, and the space aliens will come in and take over. So in other words, that keeps them in line. And it's and as von Braun said, it's all a lie. How do I know it's a lie? Because if the objective of space aliens was to come and blow up our cities and eat us or whatever, as in the movie Independence Day, they'd have done it long before now, okay? Well, they would have done it in 1947 when the only thing we had to fight them off with was machine guns and propeller-driven aircraft. Why wait until we have, you know, space beam weapons and, you know, space flat bombs, particle beam weapons, all kinds of things, lasers? Why wait until then? Nah, ain't gonna happen. But I submit to you that, like the tribe in the Amazon, we're under quarantine. They let us go a little bit out. They let us get to the moon, but we hadn't gone back. And we hadn't gone anywhere else. If we had the technology to get to the moon in 1969, don't you think we could have gone to Mars by now? But we haven't. And believe me, it's not about the money. When they finally shut down the Apollo program, we didn't send anybody back out to the moon. We had 22 of those rockets, those Saturn rockets, ready to go. But we just stopped. And they tried to say, well, it's just too expensive. Well, that's like saying, well, we built this Rolls Royce, but we don't have any money for gas. Come on. Something's going on, and we're being lied to, as we always are. We are actually pretty insignificant. We are on a third-rate planet on a fourth-rate sun out on the outer boondocks of our galaxy, okay? And for us to think that we are the apex of evolution is just about the most arrogant, chauvinistic thinking that I can even come up with, okay? But things are changing. In December of 2012, our sun comes into direct alignment with the center of our galaxy. And already they are picking up radio signals coming out of the center of the galaxy on a regular basis. And even the normally conventional and far from radical National Geographic raised the question, could they be coming from intelligent sources? So things are happening out there, and if you want to keep up with what's happening, you've got to use your mind like a parachute, okay? It works better when it's open. So keep open to all of this. If you want to, if you never entertained any thoughts about UFOs or about ETs and want to get straight facts, read my book, Alien Agenda. It's simply a journalistic account of everything we know from ancient astronauts, everything I've talked about, plus so much more, plus remote viewing. It's all in
remote
there.
Viewing,
And is it them or us when we see all this stuff flying in the skies? And now, those of you who've attended my other talks, we know that somebody's trying to rule us, right? Somebody's trying to rule and control the whole human population through secrecy and deceit. Now, we go back, we've already looked at the ancient records, we've already looked at the Sumerian tablets. They tell us that in prehistory, these ETs had colonized on the Earth. And they even say, and there are people like Sitchin who try to say, that they created us as a worker race. Let me clarify this. Even they themselves had the same ethical arguments that we're having today. It's not right to act like God and create something. And the counter argument was, we're not creating anything. We're just improving the breed. Well, wait a minute. Isn't that what we do with cows? And horses, sheep, dogs, cats, we breed them to improve the breed. And that's what they did. So don't get off in this thing saying that people are claiming that aliens created us. Nobody's trying to say that aliens created humans out of nothing. What they're saying is that they took Neanderthal, they tweaked with his DNA, and they produced Cro-Magnon, modern man. And this is why, by the way, that they will never, they have never, and will never find the missing link, because there is no missing link. They simply, and of course, up until recently, nobody understood about cloning or genetic manipulation or whatever, but they did. They even explained how they did it. In the Sumerian tablets, it said they took the egg of a earth primitive female, shall we call her Lucy, and they impregnated it with the sperm of an Anunnaki male, and then implanted the fertilized egg in the womb of an Anunnaki female. She carried it to term, and then through cesarean section, delivered a hybrid that they call the Adama, the Adam. Adam? Wait a minute. The Earth, the first Earth man. So they even explain how they did it. Of course, the problem was when they first read these ancient tablets back in the 1800s when they were first discovered, they didn't have a clue about atoms, much less genetic splicing or genetic manipulation. So they simply said, oh, well, that's their gods and these are their mythology. In fact, you can actually go to the Encyclopedia Britannica, look up Sumerian mythology, and you will pretty much hear the correct story. But it's just the only difference is that they say, well, they're just making this up. It's mythology. And a growing number of scholars are now saying, no, it wasn't just made up mythology. They were giving us our history. And this is what really happened. But we didn't understand that until recently when we could do genetic manipulation. Okay? So, assuming these ETs were on the Earth way back then and they did all this, what happened to them? Did they all leave? Or did at least some of them stay behind? Well, how do we answer that? Real simple. We look at the historical record. If the historical record is, as we have been taught in school, one slow evolutionary climb of mankind, hunter-gatherers, you know, into community, agricultural communities, and I heard a great one the other day. The reason that men built towns was and developed agriculture was so they could make beer. And then they gathered in towns so they could be close to the brewery. Makes sense to me.
Oh, hell yeah.
But then on up through city-states and nations and empires, okay? But hey, that's not what the historical record shows, does it? The record speaks for itself all the way back. You've got the air raid of 1942, you've got crop circles, you've got the flying shields of the Romans, you've got the flying dragons, you've got all these anomalies that we've already talked about. So, that means that some of them, at least, are still here. So, what does that mean? Well, there's three possibilities. Number one, we know through the historical record that some of them are still here. We also know that there's a ruling clique that's trying to gain control over us. So, the ruling elite are trying to contact these ancient creators. Or two, they've already contacted the ancient creators and are being guided or controlled by them. Or three, they are the ancient creators. Oops, I'm starting to sound like David Icke.
Hey, all right.
And that's all right. It. Thank you. Been sitting here a long time, and it's not going to bother me if you want to go move around or go find a. Oh yeah, but I will throw it open for if you got any questions, I will try to answer it. But be sure and shout out your question. I'm going to repeat it here so everybody can hear the question. Yes, sir. Yeah, there they are. He said we could repeat the three possibilities. If you assume that the ancient Sumerian tablets are correct and these ETs colonize the Earth way back there, probably setting up a worldwide, highly technological civilization, which for some reason, either through war or natural disasters, collapsed and left us with just vague memories of, for example, Atlantis. You know, everybody talks about Atlantis, and there's all these questions about Atlantis. Oh, there's an island in the Atlantic. No, it was the island of Santorini. No, it was the island of Cyprus. No, it was Antarctica before the pole shift. Okay, I submit to you, I suspect the truthful answer is yes, all of the above. We have these pyramids on the Giza Plateau. We have pyramids in China. We have pyramids in Eastern Europe. We have pyramids in South America, Central America. I think that at one point there was a worldwide, highly technological civilization which fell apart, again, either due to war and or natural disasters. And so what we're left with, and all of these anomalies,
is bits and pieces that we're sifting through thousands of years later and trying to figure out what does all this mean. But they if they were here then it appears they're still here, or at least remnants of them. And the thing that worries me is that if they are in connection with the world's ruling elite, and the reason that I don't think the world's ruling elite is really, I don't put them under the classification of good guys, because look at their track record. Just over the last 100 years, 2 world wars, depressions,
starvation still going on, pollution, the creation of deadly diseases, dissemination of deep diseases. Are all of y'all aware that we may have narrowly missed a pandemic of avian flu thanks to some alert checks who decided to check the Baxter flu vaccine, which had been adulterated with the deadly avian flu, and sent to 18 countries. Yeah, and what have we been warned about by our national leaders? Well, it's not if, but when we're going to have this national pandemic. And what is the game plan of the ruling elite? To cull the human population. And look what they're doing to the environment. Look what they're doing to the oceans. Look at what they're doing to our air. Is this the work of humans that care about the Earth or about their fellow humans? I submit to you, no. Is it being done by aliens? I'm not saying that. But I'm saying here, if they're still here, then they're either working to contact the ancient ETs, or they're already in contact with them and are being guided or controlled by them, or they are.
Old film footage of John D. Rockefeller singing like some old gospel. I mean, that is a great.
I don't know. I'm not going that far, but you never know.
I think it would probably behoove you, Jim, to write a book about zero-point energy. But my question is, are you aware that the element bismuth is vital towards above unity devices? You know what? Y'all know what an above unity device is. It means it puts out more energy than what you put into it.
Okay. What he's saying is, number one, that I should write something about zero-point energy. Well, number one, read The Rise of the Fourth Reich.
Yeah.
Zero-point energy is in there. And what he's touching on here is the propulsion system of UFOs. They do not travel by jet, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
They operate through energy fields,
yeah.
Okay? We all know the story. When the UFO comes over, the car stops. And when the UFO goes away, the car starts again. But nobody ever says, you got to turn on the ignition, and the car started back up. When the energy field comes over, if you can control gravity, you can control time. And when you get in this energy field, those pistons freeze and lock up and stop. That's the end of that. And then when the field goes away, they go back to pounding. Okay? That explains that. It also, explains missing time.
Yeah.
All right? The guy says, I saw a UFO at 6 o'clock, and I drove home, and I didn't get home until 7 o'clock, but it's only 10 minutes to my house. Missing time. When he's in the energy field, time has stopped for him. Now think about that on your way home. ETs and or ruling elites who can manipulate time.
Yeah.
Okay? And if you know for sure what's going to happen in the near future, think what kind of edge that gives you. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
Isn't it broken
probably in between 2 and 3 where the elite have the most of the Anunnaki blood and they've been married all these years. And
okay, she wants to know, in number 2, if they're already contacted, isn't there something to do then with the bloodline? Very astute. Absolutely. Every ruling elite back through the history of mankind has been concerned with the bloodline. Back to the ancient Sumerians, to the Babylonians, the Assyrians, the Phoenicians, the Babylonians, the Egyptians, to the Caesars, to the royalty of Europe, and even now over into this country. You all aware, aren't you, that Barack Hussein Obama is a cousin to Dick Cheney?
Yes.
That is not theory. That was pointed out by Dick Cheney's wife, Lynn. Okay? And that means then the Cheneys are somehow distantly related to the Bushes. The Bushes are directly related to John Kerry and to Al Gore. Which means that the Gores and the Careys and the Bushes are all blood relations to the Windsors, the ruling family of England. Again, that's not a conspiracy theory, that's conspiracy fact. And in fact, almost all but a handful of U.S. presidents have all been some way related. So in other words, right on down to the Nazis, everybody is concerned with the bloodline. Who's your daddy? Okay? And why is that? I submit to you because it goes back to what the Sumerian tablets talk about when kingship was brought to the humans. They decided they had a problem. They didn't want to dirty their hands with messing with the humans. So they'd take these hybrids that they were creating and they would make them the leaders, the kings, the overseers. They'd give them the orders, and the overseers would see that the human workers did what they were told. And this has become racial memory and has traveled all the way down till today when they say, if you're of the bloodline, then you are fit to rule. And so now we see why Barack Obama was picked out of nowhere, and probably by all accounts not even an American citizen, and built up, created. Who paid his way to Harvard? Anybody know? And why can't we see his school records? That's the thing that gets me. I mean, if you go to work for any corporation, they want to see your transcripts. Right?
They want to see everything.
They want to see everything. And you show it to them. I'll show mine. I'll show you my transcripts. I wasn't that good a student, but I graduated. Okay? And I'll show you my birth certificate. Okay? We can't see his birth certificate. We can't see his school records. Why school records? Because he's probably here as a foreign exchange student.
Right.
Okay? Now, why is this important? When you go talk to your Obama friends, and they're going to go, well, he was elected, who cares, you know? Let me tell you why it matters. It has nothing to do with Barack Obama. It has nothing to do with race. It has nothing to do with religion. It has to do with law. Are we a nation of law, or are we a lawless nation? A lawless nation is at the whims of whoever gets in control. They make the laws, and that's the way it's going to be. Does that begin to sound familiar? Because that's kind of where we are. If we say it doesn't matter that the Constitution says only a natural-born citizen can be president of the United States, and we blow that off, then we've blown off the Constitution of the United States, and we are a lawless nation. And I submit to you that this may be the plan. Because come 2012, they're probably going to try to put Arnold Schwarzenegger in the White House, and when people say, yeah, but he's not constitutionally qualified, they'll say, well, neither was Obama, and we'd okay with him. Worst case scenario is that some judge finds the cojones to order a subpoena for Obama's birth certificate, and we find out he was not born in Hawaii. The only thing they produced out of Hawaii is a certificate of live birth, which says he was born. Okay, great. No doctor's signature, no hospital, no nothing can be checked. And you can go down the road to anybody with a certificate of live birth. Mine has a doctor's signature in the hospital and the date and the time and everything else.
Pretty sure they got a shrine in Nairobi now where his birthplace is.
Everybody in Kenya says, man, thank God, one of our own people is now president of the United States, including his grandmother. Okay? But, of course, you don't get to hear about that either. But, again, it has nothing to do with Barack Obama. The danger comes is if they, at some point, a year down the road or whatever, that they say some judge issues a subpoena, we find out indeed he was born in Kenya, then the whole thing blows up, and where are we? Every decision that's made, every legislation that's passed, every law that's passed becomes null and void.
Every bailout he passed.
Everything. It's all by the words because it's all illegal and unconstitutional. Okay, again, are we a nation of law or are we a lawless nation? And then the real danger comes because then they're going to say, we need a constitutional convention. And we need to change, revise the Constitution. You already hear this already. Mm-hmm. Are you aware we're only three states away from a constitutional convention?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Okay, three states. If they say we want one, we get one. And when you convene a constitutional convention, there is nothing to restrict them to only one item in the Constitution. They can change the whole thing. Now think about it a minute, folks. Just use your head. Every lobbyist, every corporate bag man will be there. It will turn into a circus. The Second Amendment will no longer say the right of the people to bear arms shall not be infringed. It will be the right to bear arms is centered within the police agencies and the military. All right, they'll change up everything in the Constitution, and everything that you grew up with in this country will be gone. That's why it's important. Yes, sir.
Yeah, do you think the founding generation might have been clued into some of this in that they were trying to break away from it?
Yes.
The kingship, the bloodlines,
yeah,
all that
yes.
BS, they were sort of trying to say, hey, we don't want this.
Okay,
but
the question is, was the founding generation possibly aware of this kingship, this royalty, this bloodline? And the answer is very definitely yes. Okay, they may not have had the same words and the same semantics that we're using because they probably had very little or no concept of space flight or other worlds, but they knew. In fact, let's go back and look at the whole history of Western civilization. Nobody will argue with the fact that it began in between the Tigris, Euphrates rivers, which is exactly where the Anunnaki was. Then it spread northward into the Caucasus mountain regions and into what is now eastern Russia and then into western Europe. And then it moved south concurrently into Palestine and then into Egypt, then into Greece, and then into Rome, and then into western Europe. And then it went to the British Isles. And then when all that filled up, they discovered America. They came over and they filled up the east coast of the United States. And during the 1800s, it was one western migration. They all moved and filled up the whole North American continent. Why was everybody moving? Well, history makes no secret about it. They were all kept moving westward to escape religious and political tyranny. These folks have been trying to grab hold of us since the year one. And we just moved. Okay? When they got tired of Boss Tweed telling them what to do in New York, they moved to Kentucky. All right, and when they got tired of the Kentucky legislature trying to tell them what to do and how to live, they moved to Kansas. And the same thing happened, then they moved to California. Folks, the problem is there's no place left to go. We can't just run away from them anymore. We've got to stand our ground, and we've got to regain our liberty and freedom as free-born earthlings. Okay.
Costner's Garrison speech, too, about moving the capital a little further west.
Yeah, exactly. Now, here in Texas, I think Texas ought to be, you guys are here in the heart of Texas. You're here in the capital. And, you know, I'm an old reporter. Everything I've ever told you is just, here's the information, you do with it what you want to. And I'm still coming from that standpoint. But I want to encourage you people, get out there and talk. Let's regain control over Texas. I love Texas. Holy cow, what a great place. We got everything you want, and you have some stuff you don't want. But we got a great deal going here. We got resources, we got oil and gas, we got mountains, we got forest, we got seacoast, we got tropical thing, we got desert, you name it, we got it. What a great place. Why should we give all this up and let somebody in Zurich or the New World Order headquarters in Colorado tell us how to run this country? Our forefathers came here. They chased Santa Ana out. And this isn't a racial thing. Okay? there are millions of Hispanic people in Texas, and they're good Texans. They're our neighbors. They're fine, man. There's African American people living here in Texas, and they're good Texans. And their ancestors, it was their blood and sweat that built the place, okay? And there's been injustices in the past, but we've hopefully gotten over that. Let's just start working together, and let's throw out the carpetbaggers and the people who would want to tyrannize us. And I'll tell you, a good starting place is, for God's sakes, never let them take your weapons. It's the only thing that's kept us as free as we are. And the Founding Fathers knew this. Just go read the Federalist Papers. When they said the right of the public to bear arms had nothing to do with hunting or sportsmanship or target shooting, they were very explicit. They said this is what a free man must have the right to overthrow a tyrannical government. And ours, I hate to say it, is getting tyrannical. When they tell you you can't grow a garden, when they tell you you have to take a shot in a vaccination, which is proven to be dangerous at best, when they tell you you have to do this and you have to do that, that's tyranny. Okay? I don't care if it's a church or a political party or a government spokesman. When somebody tells you you can do this or you must do this and you cannot do that, that's tyranny. And we've got to resist it. And you guys are right here. A lot of you are younger folks. You're going to have to take up the banner. You're going to have to keep going, man. I'm getting old and worn out. All I'm trying to do is tell you what's going on, and then you guys have to figure out what to do about it. And let me tell you, but let me add one thing. Try to avoid violence, okay? Don't throw rocks. Don't throw Molotov cocktails. That's what they want. That's what they're looking for. If they can goad you into violence, or better yet, their usual trick is to run in agents provocateur who are going to say, hey, let's break that window, you know? If you're out at some demonstration, somebody starts to do something unlawful or violent, grab them, turn them over to a cop, haul them off, get them the heck out of there, because this is exactly what they want so they can instill martial law.
They'd
come take you, huh?
They probably are a cop.
Yeah. Most of the time they are. You ever see those pictures where the demonstrator that they arrested out of Canada,
oh, yeah,
and he's wearing the same combat boots
as
the
cop? You shall know them by their combat boots.
Exactly. Back here.
How do you suggest when they do come for our guns to defend ourselves?
Well, number one, don't let it get to the point of them coming for your guns.
Right.
When you see legislation coming up like this Hope bill, get a hold of your representatives and tell them in no uncertain terms, firmly but politely, if you vote for this bill, I will work 24/7. I will do everything I can do to see you're defeated and put out of office. And if enough people would call them and tell them that, they are just chicken enough and they are so jealous of guarding their positions, they will back down. So hopefully we'll get to that. All right. But then if they just keep going and they're coming for your guns, then band together and fight them off. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, okay, writing about the Gulag in Russia, made the comment, and I'm paraphrasing, but he said we'd sit around in the Gulag and we'd bemoan the fact that if at a certain point, when they came for people in the middle of the night and crashed down, knocked down the door, and were taking people, if we'd gathered up shovels and axe handles and tie rods or whatever and gone out there and killed them in the hallway, they would have hesitated to come around and take our neighbors, and we could have stopped it right there. He said, but we didn't. We always said, well, I'm not violating any law. I'm okay. And gee, they took my neighbor, but hey, maybe they won't come for me. And of course, when they come for you, there's nobody left to stand up. And I don't want it to get to that. That's why I'm trying to get you people to get off your tails right now and do something about it before it gets to that. But if it gets to that, you got to stop them in the hallways. Don't wait until they take you to camp, because then your chances of stopping it are zip to none.
There's a lot of excitement and energy around all the sovereignty movement stuff going on in
these
states. And our governor, Pontius Perry, even has...
I'm going to steal that.
He didn't want to get that one.
I'm going to steal that.
Well, even he supposedly has been coming on board with the excitement and the energy of this sovereignty movement. And what you're saying right here is my fear is that it's going to get flipped on us.
Right.
That's a good fear.
It's all bullshit.
They're going to get fear.
Remember when they beat you up and arrest you for wearing a peace sign? And now little kids run around with a peace sign. They co-opted it, okay? And they're going to do the same thing with this, with the sovereignty thing, you know. Well, to protect your sovereignty, vote for this anti-gun bill, you know.
Organic.
Or we're all going to, yeah, green, this environmental thing. My God, we, most of you people probably been in on the green movement since it was, before it was the green movement. But you know how they're turning that around.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's, you got to do this, you got to do that, you can't do this, you can't do that. It's all to protect the environment. Okay.
No,
it used to be to protect the kids. They always got some excuse.
Aren't the states sovereign already?
The states are sovereign, but we got to regain it.
Wouldn't this be like an opportunity for them to turn it against us, that, like he's saying right there, just by putting it up for vote, it's out. And they vote it down like they did in New Hampshire, and then flip it right there.
Yeah, you've got to be on top of this. Look at California. The majority of voters voted to legalize medical marijuana. And within a month, the feds were busting the marijuana outlets because they said, well, yeah, well, that was for state law. This is federal law. Well, excuse me, where does it all start? It starts here. Let me tell you what you need to do. You need to do like a county sheriff did up in, I think, Idaho. He sent a public notice out and said, any officer of the federal government that violates the Constitution of the United States, his deputies were going to be out and escort them to the county line because they were no longer welcome in that county. This is the kind of standing tall that we've got to start exercising.
One last thing on Zachariah Sitchin, for instance, you know, and Sumerian tablets. Do you have any caution about Zachariah in that he's really elaborate on his storyline?
Okay, he's asked me about Zachariah Sitchin. I'm sure a lot of you have read Sitchin. I've met Sitchin. At one point, he literally ran away from me because he did not want to answer my question. My question was kind of naive because this was years ago, and I thought it was a legitimate question. I was just going to say to Zachariah Sitchin, well, you know, did they all leave or did they all stay? And if they stayed, where are they? He doesn't want to answer that. I'm only going to say this. Read Sitchin. Take it as input, but don't take that as the final word. Y'all may know my friend Linda Moulton Howe.
Yes, sir.
She tells me that at one point she sat across from Sitchin, looked him right in the eye, and said, have you ever worked for the CIA? And he would not answer her. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So I would be, hey, don't trust anybody. Don't even trust me. I'm telling you what I know. I'm showing you what I know. I'm talking real openly with you. But don't trust me. Go out and do your own legwork. And basically, no, don't take everything. I know people who are Sumerian language scholars and cuneiform, can read cuneiform, and they don't always agree with Sitchin's interpretations or translations. Nothing too serious, but there are some problems there. So you got to be careful because everybody except me has an agenda.
What do you think personally of Jesus in the context of all this?
Oh, great.
And then,
the question is, what do I personally think about Jesus in the context of all of this? Well, number one, I don't see as apples and oranges. If Jesus lived and if Jesus did his ministry and if he was the forerunner of what has come to be known as the Christ consciousness, which is love your neighbor, and, you know, then so what? You know, what's it got to do, where he came from or whatever. I don't see where it's any big thing. I will say this. If Jesus, as we have been taught about him and from everything we know about him, was to actually return to the earth today, he'd be in Guantanamo.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I guess this goes a couple slides back.
Hang on to your name.
Oh, me?
No, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. This goes a few slides before that. I was wondering that where they had sent out that message, or a message of putting
the binary disk.
Yeah, the one that was encoded by
that one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the one that one and the one before. Are those considered one before that? One before that. That one right there. Yeah. But were all those considered to be legitimate?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I have checked and checked and checked, and I've not found anybody who can disprove that these were not legitimate crop circles, although, as you can see, they're not a circle. The crop was laid down. It fits criteria of a legitimate crop circle.
They didn't find, but I'm not as expert in that.
Well, as I said, on a legitimate crop circle, the crop is laid down. It's still living.
Okay.
It's not crushed. The stems are not broken. It apparently has been subjected to intense but brief heat, okay, as in a microwave.
Microwave heat.
Okay?
Yeah,
this we know, but now where does it come from, how they do that, we don't know.
Have they deciphered the solar system, some of
that? Oh, determine where that might be, not that I'm aware of.
So what if we digested those crops?
I don't think anything would happen to you.
Couldn't be any worse.
It'd be like microwaving, okay? And as I hope all you realize, when you microwave something, you kill everything in it. So you're not going to get any nutrition out of anything that's been microwaved. Okay, but I'll have to admit I'm lazy too, and it's real easy to heat something up for a few seconds in a microwave. But I try not to make my main diet out of microwave cooking. If you're microwaving, hey, it's really good for popcorn, okay? And it may be good for briefly heating something up quickly that's frozen.
Heating
but please,
water.
Huh? Or heating water. Yeah, but you know, when you heat the water or you heat your coffee or your tea,
right,
you're killing everything in it.
That might be a good idea.
So all I'm saying is please don't make your whole diet on stuff that's been microwaved. Yes, sir.
Okay. What specifically are the different names of the different kinds of extraterrestrials and interdimensionalists, and then how do they relate to, like, ancient cosmologists, like the Aztecs,
okay,
of the indigenous cosmologists?
Okay, all right. The question is, what are the different alien species and how do they relate to the ancients? All right, well, you know, let me make this analogy. If we're all outside and an airliner was going over 37,000 feet, and you pointed up and said, we all know there's people in that airliner, okay? And you say, who are they? Are they good or bad? Try answering that. You can't answer that, okay? Because there's all kinds of different people in that plane. Some of them are good, some of them are bad, some of them are indifferent, some of them in between. Okay, it's the same thing. See, we are still in the process of learning and becoming more sophisticated about these topics. In the 50s, the big question was, do they come from Mars or do they come from Venus? All right. Well, we got a little more sophisticated. So by the 70s and 80s, the question was, do they come from Alpha Centauri or Zeta Reticula 4? And today, we're even a little more sophisticated. Now you got really credible thinking scientists and people who will actually talk about it who say, well, do they come from another dimension? Do they come from another time? And I'm here to tell you the answer. The answer is yes. All of the above. Okay, we're dealing with various groups. Some of them have their own imperatives, which may not be conducive to the best interest of the humans. But as I said before, obviously overt hostility is not one of them. You may have some that have a little more benign interest in humans. But I think, now this is getting into, this is my personal theory, that there is something akin to the Star Trek concept of the Prime Directive,
mm-hmm,
which is that just like with the tribe in the rainforest, we didn't, as we would have in the past, go in and slaughter them all or give them diseased blankets or Bibles or something. We're a little more sophisticated, and we're going to study them. We're going to find out, how that works. And so I think we have gained in sophistication and knowledge, and I think that now we understand that it's not right to interfere with the natural evolution of a species. And I think that if they are advanced enough from us to have, space travel, intergalactic space travel, faster than light technology, then they're probably advanced enough to understand that it's not proper to meddle or to interfere with the natural evolution of a species. Now, whether that's a law, as we understand a law, in that if you violate it, the cops will come get you. I don't know. It may be more of just an agreement that everybody of good heart agrees that we're not going to do that, okay? But then that leaves open the question, then why do we have things like Roswell? You know, was that truly an accident? Or was that a surreptitious event to allow us to obtain advanced technology? Well, gee, you can't get us for breaking the prime directive. It was an accident. Our ship crashed. You know, that'll give you something to think about. There's all kinds of ramifications to this.
The pyramids on Mars during the alignment in three.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, in
just like on the Giza Plateau.
Right. Okay, pyramids in the Giza Plateau, pyramids in Mesoamerica are aligned like that, often for the solstice. The middle pyramid, the sun will go directly over the solstice, winter and summer. The vernal and invernal equinox will be for the. As like I know, Richard Hoagland did a lot of work on Mars. Right. Do you know anybody that's tried to do a correlate on Mars to see if it's the same thing?
All right, he's asking if I know of anybody that's trying to correlate the positions of the pyramids on Mars with the pyramids on Earth, and other than the fact that they do seem to be in the same alignment and configuration, no, I don't know of anybody that's done all of the in-depth work on it, but let me tell you something that's going to blow your mind away, okay? This is going to blow your mind, and I'm going to leave you with this. I want you to think about this. How many of you know what sidereal time is?
Mm-hmm.
One, two, three, handful. We keep time by the Greenwich time, which is based on the revolvement of the Earth around the Sun. This creates problems because right now is whatever time it is, about 9:45 here in Austin, Texas. That means it's 7:45 on the West Coast, right? And I have problems with this all the time. That means it's 10:45 on the East Coast, because we have this different time because it's based on the movement of the sun across the Earth. Right? That's the time we keep. But the ancient sailors and astrophysicists and astrologers, they have a need for a more constant time, a time that is not based on the revolvement of the Earth around the sun. So they came up with sidereal time, which is based on the positions of the constellations, okay? Because the constellations never change. Now, the sidereal time is broken into 24-hour segments, just like our time. So now I hope you understand sidereal time. We all know about the Kennedy curse. Joseph Kennedy Jr. was killed when his plane blew up off the coast of England in 1944. John F. Kennedy was killed by gunfire in Dallas in 1963. Robert Kennedy was killed in assassination in Los Angeles in 1968. And JFK Jr. died in a plane crash in 1999. Now, they already talked about the Kennedy curse, and it seems odd that these four members of the same family would all meet untimely ends. You know, that kind of stretches coincidence to a really fine point. But what if I told you that all four of those Kennedys all died within the same hour? They all died within the 16th sidereal hour. So when you take four members of the same family and they all died unnatural deaths, that's bad enough. But when you said they all died unnatural deaths within the same hour, that the odds of that are incalculable. So what am I telling you? I'm telling you that somewhere, somehow, somebody planned it that way. And be thinking about that.
Because of their Kennedy and Fitzgerald bloodline?
The fact that they... I already showed you how he was fixing to break open UFOs. He was going to stop the Vietnam War. He was trying to shut down the Federal Reserve System. He was doing everything in the world to oppose these fascist, globalist Nazis who are trying to take over the world.
But Senior Joe would have been grooming Junior Joe for
president.
Because he's firstborn.
Right.
George Bush is not the sharpest bush in the drawer, but right. He's firstborn.
But remember what I told you? If they can... negate gravity, they can alter time, and they might be able to look through time. What if somebody was able to look through time and realize that Joseph Jr. would have been an even more effective president than JFK? Can't let him get in there. So he goes on a mission, his plane blows up.
The Schwarzenegger took their women, folks. He got their bloodline,
but he married into it. Married into it, yeah.
So is Ted Kennedy like a genetic defect in the family?
Well, no, let me tell you something. Nobody remembers this, but in the summer of 1964, less than a year after his brother got killed in Dallas, Ted Kennedy was in a near-fatal plane crash, and he narrowly escaped with his life. And by the way, that occurred within the 16th sidereal hour. No, he lucked out. He lucked out and escaped the plan and probably knows it. And that's why he hasn't been anything but a drunken blowhard ever since. All right, that's it. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody wants to get over the agenda? I'll sign the book up.
Yeah, please support Brave New Books. They've got all his books here. It doesn't have to be Alien Agenda. He'll sign any of them. And please frequent this. And if you have any ideas for meetings that you'd like this room, please say something to Harlan. I'm sure he'd love to have you. And again, Monday at 3 p.m. in room E1.012. We need you there. If you go a little early, Judith McGarry will be there with some information, and you can go and actually visit these guys in their offices and put a little polite pressure on them before the actual hearing. We'd love to have
you. What is the building that we're going to?
It's the Capitol Extension, where it goes underground and goes north from the dome. It's where they do the real business of the state government now. So, love to have you there. We need you.